Stage 13 on a Friday. Ooh, it's going to be unlucky for somebody, isn't it? Who will it be? At the moment, it's a bit unlucky for you, Scott Telescardi, because they've not made the breakaway. And the poor old domestiques have to keep doing all the work. Ross it is on the front. This is the breakaway with Angel Vicioso, already a winner on the terrible day. It ended up being the last day in the life of Wouter Valent. But Vicioso didn't know, went on to take the stage. 3:15 is the gap, so it is coming down now in the valley. The work of Yuskeltel paying dividends. Two men from Saxo Bank in here, although they're doing little of the work. It's really down to the men in orange here. They've got them all up the front here, Sean. They're a bit peeved, I think, that they probably missed out. Or they're trying to set it up today for one of their eyes, maybe a Nieve or maybe Igor Anton. Igor Anton, I'm sure, is more concerned with staying close to Alberto Contador. But they have a lot of good climbers in that squad.
Yes, they have a very good squad for this type of stage we have here today. But unfortunately, you know, they're not represented up there at the break, and you know, having to do this riding with quite a few of the riders, it's going to limit the possibilities of what card they can play when they get into the final climb of the day on the Grossglockner. But we can see the breakaway is, you know, coming down 3:15 at the moment. It will depend on the next climb. If, you know, they get up that one, and then as we go further on into the valley, we could see Iscatel really saying, well, we're not going to get close enough here to go for the stage victory, and then we could see the breakaway pulling out again. For the moment, the breakaway is certainly not, you know, pushing on at anything near 100%. They know they have to get this next climb out of the way, and then after that, I think they will start making the calculation and see is there a chance of staying out there. But with 3 minutes, I don't think that's going to be enough for them to hold on in the final climb.
No, it's all about waiting for the big teams. Still 16 men together. They won't start to split up yet. I would imagine that maybe, it's a possibility anyway, that some of those 16 will try and force the pace on the next climb, the Iselberg Pass, and shed some of the other riders around them, and maybe we'll have a smaller escape group getting to the last climb of the day. Well, one Saxo Bank rider doing some work now on the front, with Yuskeltel doing most of it throughout the day. Pink jersey on the shoulders of Alberto Contador. The mountains classification jersey was on the shoulders of Filippo Savini this morning of Colnago CSF. It's doubtful whether we're still on the shoulders of Filippo Savini by the end of the day. The points jersey is being worn by Roberto Ferrari, even though Alberto Contador leads him in the overall standings. Pataki has gone home today, so has Cavendish. Ferrari is the next best placed man after Alberto Contador. Roman Koisinger wears the best young riders jersey. HTC High Road lead the team classification. They won the team classification yesterday. They move up in the overall classification. Astana still lead the team classification, as we saw Giuseppe Martinelli having a go yesterday. That's Kizilovski. Giuseppe Martinelli was having quite firm words of both encouragement and direction to this man this morning in the Astana bus. As you saw, he's gone very early as Kizilovski, but didn't have a good day a couple of days ago where he fell and smacked his teeth, chipped about two of his teeth. So Kizilovski on the charge now by himself. It was interesting to watch him, wasn't it, in the van, Sean, in the bus, when Giuseppe Martinelli was talking to him. He did look like a little schoolboy. He almost wanted him to say, yes sir, yes sir, yes sir, because he's clearly paid attention to Martinelli's insistence that he has to get in the break and try and win the stage today.
Yes, well, I think it went in and stayed in there. Sometimes with the riders, you can, you know, give them a briefing, but unless you're, you know, really come down heavy on them, sometimes they don't take it in very well. But it's interesting to see that he's going out at this point, because you know, a long, long ways to go, and I'm surprised he's taken so early. It'll be interesting to see if it'll be allowed to do that, because Martinelli, we can see in the last days, especially today, in the team orders, you know, he lays it down very, very strictly. And for me, at this point, going away, I'm surprised that he's doing that. But again, you know, the tactic could be give an attack here, go on out in front, and then hopefully there'll be five or six riders, as you said, Davis. That's what you need here. You need to get a smaller group, six or seven riders, get over this climb, and then really work well in the valley.
We were talking about Richie Porte earlier. Thanks for Anthony Tan, the Australian journalist, writing in saying that Richie, who there just threw the shot, as if by magic, Richie Porte, has had suffered with allergies all year. He's having sinus problems. Oh boy, I know that problem. It can really, really take it out of you. He's going back to Belgium after the Giro d'Italia to try and get it sorted out. Something I suffer from quite regularly. Basically, what happens when your sinuses start to inflame a little bit, your temperature goes up. You have an infection, essentially, in it. Even just a little tiny bit, it just knocks everything out of you, knocks the stuffing out of you. That's why his form is a little bit below par then. He's suffering with sinuses and allergies all of the year. I hope he gets that sorted out. Quite a different character to the race for the next 3 days. All the big favourites waiting for this last climb of the day, and probably for the last bit of the last climb, especially with that flat section in the middle. Do you think we'll see some of those big name riders who perhaps aren't really featuring yet, like Denis Menchov, Carlos Sastre, beginning to make their presence felt? Or this man here, perhaps, Rohanu, try and get away?
Yes, it is highly possible that we will see some of the riders further down the general classification trying something again. If the stage victory is to play for, that helps a lot. That, you know, the riders that are down there, from, you know, Igor Anton, for example, Menchov, as you mentioned, it's over 3 minutes down. Joachim Rodriguez at 3:22. If you're going to go for the stage victory and in the same time you're pulling back time in the general classification, that's the time you see a lot of action. So it depends on how much they will have the breakaway as we go on to the final climb. And if they have, you know, a big advantage, and it looks like there's some of them going to stay out there, then we could see just the favourites riding up together and nobody going in the attack at all.
That's Russell Downey. This is his first Grand Tour, and Russell is not a bad climber for the shorter ones, but he's beginning to suffer on this one today. This is a whole new experience for Russell Downing. Oh dear, it's a world of pain and suffering, Sean, that isn't it?
Yes, it is, and Russ seems to be suffering majorly there. You know, considering the bunch is just going at being just ridden at a pace up front, and not anything in like going 100%, but Russ has been doing a lot of work. We've seen him very active, and you know, a big tour, sometimes the first one, it can be a shock to the system.
Certainly can. I'm a big fan of Russ. Lovely bloke, and his brother Dean as well. Really lovely bloke. It's about time we got the chance to ride a great big Grand Tour with a big team. And he has done an awful lot of work. He's been leading out Apolinio, a very accomplished rider. Certainly when Team Sky started, he was their most successful rider for quite a while. In terms of wins, Robert Kieselowski is out by himself at the moment. You can see the peloton is going nowhere near 100%, as Sean said. They're just beginning to pace themselves on this Iselberg pass, although it is a fairly steep one. It's 7 kilometres at almost 10%, and that can knock the stuffing out of anybody. Roberto Ferrari here climbing pretty well at the back, even though they're not going full tilt. Had an impressive Giro d'Italia so far, Roberto Ferrari, hasn't he, Sean? I mean, he's not a very old rider. And once again, Gianni Savio has picked up some real talent there.
Yes, putting up a good show, and he has a good talent. It'll be interesting to see if he stays in the same team or if he'll be taken by a bigger team going forward, depending on the contract situation, of course. But if he's only on a one-year contract, I think we could see him getting off of some bigger teams and sitting comfortable enough there on the rear end of the peloton. And that's, you have to stay in there for the moment, because this climb after we had this good 20 kilometers in the flat, and if you can just suffer on a bit, stay in there, get over this one, well then the final climb for the sprinter guys, the non-climbers, they're just going to get up and get to the finish today.
Manuel Cardozo, another man suffering in the back. This is why sprinters in general don't like to stay in the race when it gets to three big mountain days plus a mountain time trial.
And if it was only 3 days and a mountain time trial, it would be okay, but then we go on again. Yep. And mountain day after mountain day, and that's what is putting the sprinters out of the race. There's nothing left for them. There's not a flat stage all the way to the finish in Milan, so you can understand why the sprinters are getting out. And some of the sprinters are staying in here, not the top ones, but they are, hanging in there. And there's probably a number of them that need a bit more miles, a bit more racing days in the legs to get their shape. But when you get this off the terrain, it's so difficult for them even to, hang in the bunch, as we've seen with some of them.
Kieselowski out by himself. He's had a pretty good season so far. Early season was good. He was in the Tour of Sardinia and did quite well there, top 10 in the Tour of Sardinia, got a couple of stages, top 10 in the Giro del Trentino, and then it just sort of tailed off a little bit, but he's seemingly coming back into form. This is often the case, of course, that a rider will shine early on, or he'll shine in certain races, and then he'll have a bit of a break, or the form will just dip a little bit because he's not particularly targeting those, and you can come back to a peak later on in the season. It's almost impossible, isn't it, Sean, to, for example, let's take Philippe Gilbert as a good example. Starts off the season relatively low key, works his way up towards the early season classics, and then the full classics, Ardennes classics. It would be, and we've seen he's been unbeatable this year, it would be almost impossible to keep that level of form going right the way through to, say, the Giro d'Italia, and then to the Tour de France, and then to the Vuelta and so forth.
Yes, impossible to hold it for that amount of time. The real top shape, you only hold it for a number of weeks, and if you keep on pushing and suffer a lot, then you pay the price later where you have a big downtime. So they do a number of weeks, get ready, then really have it at their top level of fitness for 3-4 weeks, and then knock it back, take a couple of weeks rest, and that's what the stage racers do. Kieselowski, for example, the early season he ride a number of races, get the form pretty good, and then a certain period before the Giro, which he would have known he would have a huge role within the team here, take it easy and try and get back to your best just for the Giro.
Talking of riders, we'll have to try and get back to their best. We send our best wishes to our perennial favourite Jens Vogt, who fractured a scaphoid bone in the Tour of California, which is pretty painful, isn't it, Sean, the scaphoid? You're putting pressure on it all the time, holding the handlebars, and it can be difficult if you can't. Oh, that's Sylvester Schmidt of Liquigas. Although Nibali said he's not in his best form, he's not in any sort of form by the look of it. Schmidt, who is a really super climber, off the back of the peloton. Ooh, that's looking not very good. I wouldn't be surprised if it's not the last we see of him today, Schmidt, if that's going to be the case. Yes, Jens Vogt, fractured scaphoid, and needs an operation, can be quite painful.
Yes, very painful, and if you go on the bike, it really hurts, and it's not advised to ride the bike at all, because the scaphoid is one which needs to be rested for a number of weeks. It's the one that I done in a crash in the mid-80s, and the doctors are, you know, very much take a number of weeks off because you have to leave it set well, and it does hurt a lot if you try and ride the bike at all on the road, where with the collarbone, it's, you know, it's a much less time out. So for Jens, it's going to be a difficult one for him to get back and be in shape for example, Tour of France.
Kieselowski, former rider with Liquigas, and he's nailed his colours to the mast today. He's out with two climbs left to go. He's on the Iselberg Pass, which is a pretty steep one, and he's ridden away from his 15 breakaway companions who are still behind. They are Lastras, Wiening, Sarmentio, Valsferez, Samalau, Losada, Vicioso, Lewis, Nordhaug, Noe, Hugeland, Nocentini, Van der Valmeyer and Spezialetti. We haven't really seen how they are all split up at the moment. The last thing we saw was Kieselowski disappearing off the front, and that was that. There's a lot of riders beginning to suffer here. Taking the bottles on board is Maxim Belkov. There's somebody cheekily writing in and saying, have the organisers of the Giro made sure that all the team cars take their wing mirrors and rear wipers off today? There's some fantastic pictures on the internet of it. They shall remain nameless riders hanging on at every little thing that's sticking out of the car on the climb up Mount Etna. Non-climbing riders, obviously. Oh, it's all part of the game, and it has been for many, many years. There hasn't been a time in cycling when they haven't tried to pull a fast one. In the very first Giro d'Italia, I think two riders were chucked out for taking trains. Same happened in the Tour de France. All sorts of things. Incidentally, we had a lot of questions asking, why does the Giro d'Italia finish in Milan and not in Rome? Well, the reason's quite simple. You see that pink jersey there of Alberto Contador. The pink of that jersey reflects the paper, Gazzetta dello Sport, who back the race and always have done, and they still run the race ever since its first running in 1909. They've always controlled the race, the route and so on. They do all the logistics, Gazzetta dello Sport, and they're a Milan-based paper. Simple as that. That's why they finish in Milan and not in Rome. Although they have finished in Rome, of course, but generally it's in Milan. Just sitting sort of mid-pack at the moment is Alberto Contador. There's Visconti in the top of your shot, the Italian champion with the tricolour jersey on. Not wanting to do too much in this climb, any of the riders, Sean, because it's quite a testing climb, and if the pace gets forced too hard, then everybody will be strung out all over the mountain.
Yes, and I think the situation with our group of riders up the road, 16 in the breakaway, you know, there's so many teams that are represented up there, and a lot of the teams are going to say, well, we have got a man out in front, there's no need to start riding here, and the only one has been riding for a long time and still at it is the Escatel team. Unfortunately for them, they just missed out big time today, and if it wasn't for them, this break could really pull out a big advantage, because I think you know, Lastras at 6:58, he might be, you know, taking over the race leader's jersey today if we hadn't the Escatel team prepared to chase it down.
Stage 13 of the Giro d'Italia, Spilimbergo to Grossglockner in Austria. And already riders beginning to fall off the back of this main peloton group, including Sylvester Schmidt, the Polish super climbing domestique from Liquigas. Vincenzo Nibali this morning already saying he wasn't in good shape, and he doesn't look it at all, looking in all sorts of pain and suffering as he went off the back. Other riders we've seen slipping gently off the back, Emmanuel Cardoso. One rider who was fighting to stay on was Britain's Russell Downing. But, Cardoso, quicker on the flat, and so is Downing. At the front of the peloton, it's Jusco Telescardi doing the work. We saw a wonderful picture of Massimo Codol then, on the right-hand side of your shot now, in the red and white, about 12, 15 back, looking after Stefano Gardeccia, the winner of the Giro d'Italia, as far back as the year 2000 now. It's a very long career to be up at the front in the Giro d'Italia, Sean. It's 2011 now, and he won in 2000. But he's there, he's still there, he's still competing at the highest level here.
He certainly is, and we've seen him in the past. The stage taken very much up there. He's in good shape, and I don't think we've seen the end of him yet. In the days to come, he will definitely try and, you know, take a stage victory out of this one. General classification, he might have difficulty staying up there all the time, and I feel that he will have a day where he will suffer and lose some time. But stage victories, he'd not give up on that, and he will, you know, keep on fighting and try and get at least one stage victory out of this Giro before we get to Milan.
Yep, I'm pretty certain he's going to try for one. Maybe a day like today, who knows, when the rest of the favourites are thinking this may not be the day when we win the Giro d'Italia, but we have to make sure we cut our losses. And then a rider like Gardeccia, who in realistic terms, whoop, a little bit of action on the front of the remaining breakaway group, the two men from Movistar are Samalau and Pablo Lastras. They're pushing on a little bit now, as Kieselowski gets to the top of the climb first, and going well. He had 102 over the rest of the breakaway riders. Gardeccia may benefit from a day like today. Certainly tomorrow he's going to have trouble on Zoncolan. But on a day like today, when all the rest of the big favourites are looking at Alberto Contador and looking around them, it's rather appetising. Day that perhaps Gardeccia might go quite well. Looking at the bikes today, Sean, every time we get questions from people wondering what sort of gear ratios they're running on this, nothing untoward, I wouldn't think.
For today, I think it's not going to be a problem, and you know, the gearing will be pretty much the normal, where they will have, you know, the double chain ring and probably a 25 sprocket on the rear. But as we go forward, and we've talked about in the past as well, then they, you know, some have triple chain rings because the gearing you need is so low that it's not just possible with the standard one. So for today, I think we will see just the normal. But there will be, you know, a number of days here where they will have to make drastic changes.
That's Roberto Ferrari from Androni in the red jersey there of the points leader. As a sprinter, you can see what's happening. He's now being tailed off the back here as they reach the top of the Iselberg Pass. That's Sasha Modolo in the blue there, another sprinter. Got tangled up with Robbie Hunter yesterday. It was rather entertaining in that corner where the Androni rider ran wide and there was a little tumble in the middle. One of the riders who went down was Sasha Modolo, and the other one was Robbie Hunter. One of the other ones was Robbie Hunter of Radio Shack, who proceeded to throw his bike at Modolo in a fit of disgust and then grab him by the vents of the helmet, shake his head about, which was interesting. Made for entertainment. Not hard, just made for entertainment. That did. They've done a lot of work of Yuskotel here. Very keen. And neither hide nor hair being seen of Igor Anton on the front. And rightly so. He will be hoping to make the cut in the final 10-12 riders as they go up the Grossglockner today. Marco Pinotti on the right-hand side of your screen, the HTC rider coming to the front, riding next to Richie Port. Joaquim Rodriguez, seeing the shot in the middle there, the Katusha rider. Not the first one, the second one on the road. Just behind him, David Arroyo. Rides of the very head-up style, David Arroyo. You could always recognise him because his head's always pointing quite high up, tilted quite high up. Arroyo is riding well again this year, Sean. Slightly unusual situation last year. I don't think he expected to be in the pink jersey and have to defend it all the way, but this year he's come here with some more purpose to do that.
Well, I think last year when he got into the position with the pink jersey, he put up a super battle to hold on for a long time, and then he hung in very well in the Giro, and I think that gave him confidence that he can do a big tour and can do a general classification. And it's all about a learning process as well. Some of the guys, they're in there in the Tour of Italy, the Tour of France, and they don't be in a position, they never get into the position where they have to try and defend a real important place, but because we get into a breakaway, they get to that situation sometimes, and then from there on they become better stage race riders. And talking about Russell Downing as well, his first tour, first Grand Tour, it might be his last one, because again for Russ it's his feeling, and how he's going to get through a 3 week tour. And on the try, you never know. And of course, Russ, we know him in some other races, he's a real good biker in other sorts of races. The big tours might be not for him, as it is for other riders.
Got to give it a go though. It is the thing that every rider aspires to, Sean, isn't it? I mean, to be able to be picked for a Grand Tour, most especially, I guess, the Tour de France, but any Grand Tour to be picked for is a high point in your career.
Yes, certainly to do a big tour, and to do a 3 week tour as a profession is something that when you become a bike rider and you're a good up-and-coming rider, and the possibility to become professional is out there, you always think about doing a 3 week tour. And first of all, you try maybe with a Tour of Spain or something, and the Tour of France is the big one that you want to get if you're in a team that is in the in line for a place in the Tour of France, or going to ride the Tour of France. But then when you get into the race, sometimes the body reaction, you're okay in a week long race, you can race very aggressively all the way through, get to 12 or 13 days, the body starts to get tired, it doesn't recover, and then if that continues on for a number of years, well, for a 3 week tour, it's always going to be difficult. And there is some riders like that, they can be so good in a race like Paris-Nice, yeah, Dauphiné, but the 3 week tours, they cannot manage it.
We often see it, don't we? We often see riders who are touted as the next big thing, who really, when it comes to a 3 week tour, they start to fade towards the end. They're greater, but 7 or 10 days, but other than that, they're not particularly great. They can't manage the 3 week tour. What is it that makes a 3 week tour rider successful? What is it that makes a 3 week tour rider? I mean, that's the question, really. Where you could have a rider who just oozes talent and then can't really do much more than 10 days.
I think first of all you have to be a good week 10-day rider. You have to be able to win those races. A race like Paris-Nice is the first step probably. Then you go to maybe a Dauphiné, or you go to a Tour of Switzerland, which are 10 days. And if you can win them, then you're made another step. But there's a few more steps to go. The 3 week race is always a difficult one, and then you have to try the 3 week tours. And if you can race aggressively for the 3 weeks and in the last week, well then that you can be a contender for a general classification. So it's a very slow process working up all these steps. And some riders are so good in a race like Paris-Nice, they can be very dominant, but when they go over the 10-day racing, the body just doesn't continue on to recover. And if you're not recovering rightly, well then you just go downhill slowly every day, and after 2.5 weeks the body is empty and you're just really hanging in there, and there's no way you can stay with the top guys or with the top group on the difficult stages.
Well, Tommy, pleased to get down this last descent of the day. You can see what happens in the mountains here. You get mountain streams that run across the road and leave wet patches on the road as you get to corners. You saw how gingerly some of the riders were going around them. 3:35, and other teams now coming to the front to add firepower. The work has been done by Euskaltel Escardi. Still 3:34 from Kieselowski back to this group. Now, normally we would say 1 minute for every 10 kilometres if it's a fairly flat route. That's about the cut-off point for being caught. But on a day like today, 31.9 kilometres to go, 3:34. That man there, Kieselowski, will be very hard pushed indeed to stay away. The ascent of the Grossglockner is coming up. It's the first time it's been used in the Giro d'Italia for 40 years, although it's a regular, of course, in the Tour of Austria. A bit of information about that in just a minute. And of course it gets used in the Tour of Germany as well, where they want some big mountains. It's actually the second highest mountain after Mont Blanc in Europe, although but we don't go right the way to the top, of course. We'll take a short break and it's back for the mountain. 3 minutes and 31 seconds for Robert Kieselowski. Had a very good early season, as we've said. He's got good placings in the Tour of Sardinia right at the early part of the season. Then tailed off a little bit. We saw him getting a stern talking to by Giuseppe Martinelli, the director sportivo of Astana, in our Inside Astana exclusive vignette at the beginning of the programme. Certainly taken that to heart, Sean, but it's a long road by yourself out there.
It's a long road, and I'm afraid it's going to be just that too long. When you look at the situation, the 16 riders in that breakaway, he went in the attack on his own, and I was thinking, well, there'll be other guys who will join him, and I reckon he might have been hoping that as well, where there, you know, be four or five, six riders from that original 16 come to him, and then they go on. But here, out on your own, you know, he's been out there on that climb. He's the 20 kilometres in the valley, which he's, you know, getting to the end of, and that's going to be, you know, a one which will mark him as well. He'll pay the price for that. And when you look at the advantage, 3:30 at the moment, and also he have the breakaway in between, the chasers in between. So it's going to be difficult to see him holding on. And when you look at the riders in the breakaway, Kieselowski, I think he would have a very good chance if he came with all 16 to the final climb of the day. So I'm not sure if the tactic, you know, is the best one. I certainly, you know, if, as a director of sportif, I would question it immediately when we see Kieselowski going in the attack. I would have, you know, much preferred to take three or four riders with him from that 16-man group and go on ride in the valley, because when you're riding with five or six riders, you know, it makes it so much easier in the 20 kilometres in the valley section to get to the final climb, where he is going to have put in a big effort. And then when you get to the climb, often we see the riders paying big time on the final climb of the day.
Roger Strangeli is the man in the middle of the shot in the rather fetching Slovenian national colours, national champions colours. Valerio Agnoli of Liquigas in the lime green there. Back on the front come Jusko Telescardi. That even so, although Kieselowski's out by himself, they're not cutting down the gap particularly quickly. The peloton are quite well strung out. 28.2 kilometres still to go. The climb itself is 20.7 kilometres to the finish line. It's 13.5 kilometres to the GPM point. So got 13.5 kilometres of climbing to get to the mountains classification, and then there's a flat for about 3 kilometres, and then it rises again. Pablo Lastras and Branislav Samolov try a counterattack to get out of the chasing group, or what remains of the escape group, and move across to Kieselowski. Hasn't happened yet. Just one bit of news for you from Race Radio. Number 34, Martin Kohler, the former Mountains jersey wearer for BMC, has withdrawn from the race, as is number 196, Davide Apollonio of Sky, their sprinter finishing second yesterday, but withdrawing from the race today. So that's Kohler of BMC, number 34, out of the race today. And number 196, Davide Apollonio of the Sky team, out today as well. It means BMC have now lost three riders, unfortunately. Kohler, because he's withdrawn today. The other two are Chris Barton, who didn't finish stage five after crashing in the centre of a tarmac bit of road, not the start of Bianchi. And Chris Butler, who had to withdraw after a fracture, I think it was a pelvic fracture. Didn't start stage nine. Well, the weather's a little more cool for the riders today. They'll need it going up this mountain, one has to say. We have a lot of questions about helmets on mountains. If you're just coming back to cycling, it's been the case, I'm afraid, that riders have to wear their helmets all the way up a mountain now. There was an occasion after the helmet laws were brought in where, for a while, riders on the last climb of the day could remove their helmets if they wished to, but that has long since gone by the board. Essentially, riders have to wear helmets in UCI events all the time. So the counter-attack from Lastras and Samalau coming to nothing, and they've gone back into this chasing group of 15 riders. Kieselowski's going great guns here, Sean, because the peloton's being dragged along by three men from Euskaltel's Cardi, and they're hardly making any impression at all.
No, not a big difference in the advantage for Kieselowski back to that main group, and surprising because the Euskaltel riders looks to be pushing on quite strongly, but Kieselowski putting in a good performance, and we can see there he is giving it a lot here, a lot of movement on the bike. And for Kieselowski, it's the difficult section. Dog running across the road there. So it's he's doing a good job. But the interesting one will be now to see where is the rest of the breakaway. We're not getting any time on that, the 15 guys who are chasing down Kieselowski, because they are in a real good position. They're working well together, and that's where Kieselowski, I think, the big danger is going to come from, because the 3 minutes at the moment, it's looking okay, but again, I think it will be all depending on the situation back in the main bunch. You know, if we have somebody who will keep riding on the earlier slopes of the Grossglockner, well then, this gap will come down a lot. But who's going to ride back in the bunch? I think Escatella are going to be pretty cooked when they get to the earlier slopes, and then they will be just to slow down. They'll be looking at each other, and that breakaway of 15 chasing your lone leader will still hold on to the 3 minute plus advantage.
That's Cam Meyer in the centre of your shot. There he is, time trial national champion last year, but he really is noted for his world championship successes as well. On the boards, he is an excellent all-round rider, a superstar rider, and rides and supports Bike Pure as well. Look it up, Bike Pure, well worth signing up to, give your support to the sort of riding you want to see in professional cycle sport. 308 to the pink jersey group, 103 back to the 15 members remaining of the escape group from Kieselowski. Is the gap from this man back to the big jersey on the shoulders of Alberto Contador. Well, he's putting in a mighty effort to Robert Kieselowski, but he's got this to face. I don't think it's going to happen for him today, unfortunately. Ooh, rain forecast. Well, at least they're going up and not down. Not too much of a breeze, as you can see, both from the board at the bottom of the screen and from the flags on the side of the road. But 2:44, 24 kilometres to go. Kieselowski, I'm afraid, as Lorenzo Laplage gives him another bottle, is, well, I think he's on a hiding to nothing here, Sean. I don't know about you.
Yeah, it's looking difficult, and he is struggling there to keep it going. And I'm not surprised, because Kieselowski is a climber, and this section is really difficult for him. Back to the chase, as we've just heard, around a minute and 2 seconds, and as we can see, back to the bunch is coming down as well. A lot in the last number of kilometres. Kieselowski there on his specialised S-work, so he'll have to work well if he's going to hold on and get a stage in this one, because we can see the breakaway. I think there's some guys there who are going to benefit from this, and they're going to come out of the group very strong. And it's not finished in my reckoning. Back in the bunch with 2:35 at the moment, if we get action immediately on the earlier slopes of the Grossglockner,
you could do anything with that pun, couldn't you? Super works, seldom works, sometimes works. Here's the rain, it's beginning to come. Kieselowski still got that valley road out ahead of him, but charging in towards the foot of the Grossglockner, which is in total is going to be 20.75 kilometres in length, so still a couple of K to go before he gets to the bottom of it. He might, of course, take the points for the mountain. You can try, it's a long way though, 13 kilometres. Incidentally, he hasn't got any points at all on the mountains classification so far up until today. Keselowski got the last mountain. 9 points to the better. The man at the top is Filippo Savini with 16 points. I guess Keselowski could be on a purpose that he can gain enough points in the mountains classification to try and take that over the next couple of days, but with a mighty, mighty effort going up the Grossglockner today, I haven't seen too much in his form to indicate that he could keep up that sort of performance day after day. You never know, he might be riding himself into form. We were talking about riders who are better at 3 weeks than others. People were talking about it on Twitter. Spokesmen is the Twitter feed, S-P-O-K-E-S-M-E-N, if you want to get in touch with us and make any comments or ask any questions. We can't answer all of them, by the way, and sometimes they're not actually pertinent at that particular point of the race, so we might leave them, or you'd have to come in with them again at some point. Roberto Contador, I'm working his way back up towards the front. He's clearly been back to the car, I would imagine, at some point. Luis Leon Sanchez was a rider, a modern rider, that's been mentioned two or three times on the Twitter feed, saying he's a rider who can ride 7 to 10 days, but struggles a bit more in a three-week tour. Who were the riders in your day, Sean, that showed themselves as genius riders in 7 to 10 day tours, and then when it came up to the 3 weeks, really struggled? I'm thinking of maybe someone like Jeff Bernard was a fantastic rider over 10 days, and then when it came to the pressure of doing 3 weeks, he had a little bit more trouble.
Yes, I think a good one, Bernard. He was really good in the shorter races, but again in the Tour of France he was up there on a number of times, so he adapted pretty well. But there's other riders in the Paris-Nice, they were really good, and you go back a lot of years, Michel Laurent, the French rider, he was very good in the Paris-Nice race and in shorter races, but in the Tour of France, I think in the general classification, you would have to go down a long ways to find his finishing position. Where Jeff Bernard, he wasn't that far off in the Tour of France, and there's some riders that won the week-long races, but in the three-week races were really out of the general classification totally.
Yeah, the rain is definitely coming down now, but as we say, at least they're going to climb now. Although it has been known to people to fall off going uphill, even in the semi-dry. Here's Roberto Contador. He's taking the rear brake, slackening the rear brake off here on the bike. My guess then probably is that he had a slow puncture or a puncture. That is why he went back, got a new wheel, has got back on into the bunch, and it's often the case that if he gets slotted into the dropout slightly differently, just release that brake. He's not going to be using it an awful lot. Make sure that it doesn't rub. Yes, it has been known for riders in the current peloton to fall off, even going uphill. It's in the slightly damp. Denis Menchov is a prime example. A few years ago, we're cruising around a hairpin, a left-hand hairpin, and then fell off, going uphill. One of the more entertaining offs of Dennis.
It wasn't even a hairpin.
Was it not? I thought it was.
Well, not really.
I seem to remember it.
Not a real hairpin.
A real hairpin, no. A wide bend then.
Yes, and it was amazing the way he fell off. But again, it was the same situations we're having here, where it was really dry conditions and we got the rain in the stage of the Tour of France, actually in Italy. We got a little bit of a shower as we came to the final climb of the day. And when you're there climbing and dancing on the pedals, and a little bit of a turn at all, you can slide out. But of course, Menchov, we have seen him fall in many different ways. We remember the Tour of Italy when he crashed here 2 years ago in the time trial.
Which particular Tour of Italy he crashed in?
A couple of hundred metres from the line. That's on right. The final time trial. That was a real spectacular one.
It really was. In the pink jersey, in the time trial, that was the one into Rome, in Rome. It was a spectacular finish all the way around the streets of Rome. Very difficult course. He came thundering around the last corner, down the last straight, and fell off 250 metres, a bit more from the line, and had to get back on. And actually, the thing that saved his Giro d'Italia at that point was the presence of mind of the mechanic in the car, who was, because obviously Dennis was so shaken, he didn't quite know what he was going to do. But the presence of mind of the mechanic, Sean, was the man who steadied him and got him back on the bike, and away he went, and he won the Giro, kept the pink jersey. But he did have it's very unfair, but he did have a reputation for falling off quite regularly. It even got to the point, I think he was playing on his own mind, where we saw him in some stages come across something that was slightly damp. You'd see a lot of white lines on the road, and you'd physically see him tense up, thinking, oh, here we go. And it seems to have overcome that, thank goodness.
Well, of course, if you get a number of falls and you know, you're a little bit scared, then your confidence, you lose it a bit. And when you lose the confidence, you know, that's when you tighten up and you panic a bit as you go into the corners. And they're the moments then when you fall more. So to get over that period and to relax a bit more, get your confidence back, you can have, you know, a number of falls again. And, you know, Menchoff, I will always remember the one in that final time trial of this Giro. On a straight line, actually, you know, whatever way he just got out of the saddle, made it, you know, a movement and put the pressure on the pedals, and the bike just went straight from under him. And that, you know, can really bash your confidence for quite a while.
Yep, I think that's what happened with Menchoff. His confidence went, because there was a whole spate of them, all one after another. Yeah, it's a Mapai jersey. Seen one of those for a while. Dreadful thing. There have been some shockers over the years, and some really, really good ones. Ah! Maybe that's the walker on the snowfield. Finally made it after 3 weeks. She was 28 when she started. This is the Grossglockner. And a bit of mist hanging around over the higher portions of this mountain, which is the highest in, I must qualify what I said, Western, second highest in Western Europe. After Mont Blanc, 20 kilometres to go for the peloton then. After 40 kilometres today, 16 riders got away. They were Lastras, Wiening, Kizilovski, Sarmiento, Valls Ferrez, Samelau, Losado, Vicioso, Lewis, Nordhaug, Noe, Hoogeland, Nocentini, Van der Waal, Meyer and Spezialetzi. Only one of those remains at the front of the race, and that's because he rode off into the distance. It's Robert Kieselowski. And Kieselowski at the moment has 2 minutes and 5 seconds over the peloton. Somewhere in between those two are the 15 remaining men. Not starting this morning, unsurprisingly, all sprinters. Cavendish, Renshaw, Pataki, Hondo, Baletti and Ventoso electing not to start the mountain stage today because there's 3 days of it still to go, and a couple of other riders withdrawing today. Apollonio, the sprinter from Sky, and Martin Kohler, who wore the mountains classification, did a fantastic ride on stage 5, has abandoned today as well. Not too much of a breeze today, but it's a tailwind. That'll help, Sean.
Well, it will help out,
in, fit.
Out in front, of course, it will help the riders who you know, are trying to hold on out there with a little over the 2 minute advantage. But if you're with good climbers and you're in a little bit of difficulty, it doesn't help in that situation because they will go faster again.
Seventeen and a half kilometres to go there into the climb of the Grossglockner now. Let's just have a good look at the profile of this climb for you and just describe it. It's about 2.5 to 3% for the first 5 kilometres, so not so bad. It starts, it's about 20.7 kilometres in length, so they're already 3 kilometres into it. In about a kilometre and a half, it'll start to ramp up quite a bit, 5.5%. And then after another 2K, it goes up to 9.2%. It then just increases its gradient as we go on to the top of the GPM point there. By the time we get to 13.5 kilometres in length, we've gone through a section, a maximum section of 14%, which is about 500 metres long. But the average gradient between 9.5 kilometres and 13.5 kilometres is 10.5%. Nasty stuff. Then they drop down a little bit onto a flat for 3 kilometres, and then they start climbing again at nearly 6.5%. Now, Sean, in, amongst the favourites here, anybody going to, what sort of riders would you expect to launch any sort of attack, if any, before the peak of the Grossglockner, not the finish, but the GPM point?
I think first of all the calculation will be, you know, out the book. When you look at, you know, what's out front, what the situation is, one lone rider and then the chasing 15 riders, we can see here the gap is coming down, and the Escatel has done a big job today. So immediately the pressure maybe is on Anton a bit to try and do something, to get something out of the big day's work they've put in. You know, he has to try and do something, and in the earlier part I think, you know, you can do the damage before the GPM point because it's very, very steep there. But there's surely other riders who will want to go on the attack as well. Garzelli, he, you know, will be looking for a stage win. Will we see Menchov trying to do something? Joachim Rodriguez, Serpa, for example, Rugano. There's a lot of very good climbers in there. I feel that some of the, you know, the lesser known men who are real good climbers, I think we should see some of them. And I'd not be surprised if, you know, the Androni team, they try and do something, because they have quite a few of riders capable of doing a big performance today.
I should have said this earlier. A lot of people are asking the question, what does GPM stand for? It's Grande Premio della Montagna. So it's the point where you go over the categorized point of the climb, where the points are available. So when you go over the GPM, the Grande Premio della Montagna, that's where you get the points. Today, it's at 13.5 kilometres. That's not, however, the finish of the climb. That's not the finish of the day. It's just after the steepest point, which is why they put those points available there. 15.8 kilometres to go. The rain has been falling into the valley, not hard, just enough to make it a little bit slippery. But up at the top of the Grossglockner, it seems to be okay at the moment, although the rain, as you can see, is beginning to come in from the side. It's being blown in towards the finish. If you look at the road surface, it's beginning to start a little bit of a sheen on it. The rain on the camera lens is beginning to show. It's okay here at the moment, but it looks as though before very long we're going to get some of that rain showers, some of that rainstorm sweeping in over the finish here at the Grossglockner. Now, it's been used many times before, this mountain, not just for the Giro, which was 40 years ago the last time it was used in the Giro, but it's a regular feature of the Tour of Austria. Back in 1957, a Briton, Bill Bradley, won stage 6 of the Tour of Austria on this mountain, and he held the record for the climb for many, many, many years. I can't remember what the record was, but it stood for an awful long time. I think Bill Bradley's part of the Southport Cycling Club. But a great, great climber.
Oscar, in a little bit of trouble here. Oscar Gatto.
Oscar Gatto, the cat.
Of course, the sprinters, it's, you know, over for them, and they're just going to cruise in. It's not that they're all in difficulty here, they're just looking about, and they will just make a group and get to the finish today.
How does that work, Sean, for just to explain how the bus works?
Well, I think it's going to be easy to work the bus today, as we can see here, you know, a number of riders just out the rear, and you just form a group, and somebody goes to the front, start making a slower pace where everybody is pretty comfortable enough with, and just gets the finish. And when you're inside, you know, the 15 kilometres or inside the 20 kilometres to go, it's not a problem. There's a huge amount of time to play with. In the earlier part of the stage, when you have a mountain to start, then it's more difficult because you have a lot of kilometres to cover and you have to ride very hard to make it inside the time limit. And we did here on Etna there was a lot of talk about Cavendish and a number of the riders really fighting to make it within the time limit.
The green jersey on the shoulders of Filippo Savini this morning. We said he's very unlikely to keep it today because he's not really a climber. He was just out in a break where he took a lot of points. And the rain is coming down here at the finish. The man's wearing a camera on his helmet, if you're wondering what it is. The green jersey of Savini is dropped from the bunch. and he'll be just left to his own devices, I would imagine. Not really helped out in any way, because it's, there he is, Filippo Savini. As you can see, none of his Colnago CSF teammates around him, and it would be a waste of their efforts, really, because Savini is not a natural mountain climber. He's done well to get that jersey in. It's a great honour for him to hold it. But the man they'll be looking after is Domenico Pozzivivo, who is a very good climber. Chasing groups at 40 seconds. The pink jersey group is at 125, back on Kizilovsky. And fracturing behind, yep, the man you just saw on your screens in the red and white is Samiento of Acqua Sapone, the Colombian climber, and it looks as if both of, or at least one of, the Movistar riders, last as I would expect, is leading the charge to stay up with Samiento. The rain now coming down steadily at the finish in Grossglockner here. Still a fairly constant tailwind towards the top. It's not heavy, but it's constant. Well, look at that, sweeping in across in the valley and then up towards the finish at Grossglockner. We could be inundated, fairly soon. You might even see somebody, many of the riders coming up. I imagine it'll blow over before it gets here, if it rises as hard as, raises itself as high as the finish line. Back with the peloton. Thank you, Odysseus. Bill Bradley's climb, 20 kilometers in 56 minutes, 53 seconds. Bradley holding the record of Britain. Bill Bradley was indeed part of Southport CC, says Lanks Tandem. Oh, nice to see a fellow Tandemier on here. His memorial is at the top of the Trough of Boland. There's a lot of shots of nothing going on here, other than some weather closing in. And a couple of leisure riders coming up to finish their ascent of the Grossglockner. Probably a bit slower than Bill Bradley's old record. Sarmiento, it appears from race radio, has passed Kizilovsky now, and Kizilovsky has been joined by the four riders that were chasing him. So there's now five, with the Colombian Sarmiento of Acqua and Sapone, who is leading the ride on the road at the moment. Hopefully we'll get some shots very shortly. There's Stefano Garzelli, third back in the train of red and white there. And as we suggested earlier, Sean, it could be a day where he might try something towards the end, because he would dearly love to take a stage win. I think he knows in his heart of hearts he's unlikely to win the Giro overall.
Yes, very unlikely to win the Giro overall. The last number of years he's had difficulty on one, if not more, of the big mountain days. And he's probably scared he's going to get that again. And I think the stage victory is what he's aiming for. For the moment, we have Salmimento, who is a teammate. So again, they're not going to start pulling it here. They're going to just follow the train and the pace being set by the Escatel rider, Neve. And it's going to be an interesting one. Who else is going to take it up? Is there anybody? It takes one team out of the equation for the moment with Acqua and Sapone, because they would certainly be, you know, interested in riding here and really keeping the pace very high as we come to the 13 kilometres of the finish.
Sarmiento up ahead of everybody, riding for Acqua Sapone, and there's Massimo Cadol in the white helmet, the first of the Acqua Sapone riders here in line with Nervi doing the work on the front. And there is Garzelli, another white helmet, but with the snow leopard on it. Earpiece out of the radio, that's telling. I think possibly he thinks, well, there's nothing much that I can be told from the car now. I just do what I do. Right behind him is the form of David Arroyo from Movistar. In the blue with the lime green helmet. In the middle of your shot, in the pink and the blue, just lying back another bike length, is Michele Scarponi. Christopher Lemavel is on the near side of your shot, a sandwich between the riders and the wall. Typical style, he gets hunched over the bike and pulls on the bars quite a lot. The pink jersey of Alberto Contador is about 15 riders back in the center of the shot. Just behind him is Konstantin Svitsov. On the other side of him, on the right side of your shot, in the lime green jersey, is Vincenzo Nibali. Coming up on the far left-hand side of your shot, making his way towards the front, is Rujano, the little rider from the Androni team. Rujano, the Venezuelan, who was the only man to be able to stick with Alberto Contador, roughly speaking. Peter Wiening has now, we understand from race radio, put on a bit of an acceleration, a spurt from out of the 15 that he was with. It's fractured now, of course. And Sarmiento, the Colombian, is now being joined by the Dutchman, who's already won a stage and the pink jersey for a while here. So he's having another go for glory today, Peter Wiening. Wiening has lost a lot of time over the last few days, and certainly couldn't hang on to the pink jersey for too long. When it got to Etna, he was out of the back door. Feeling better today, though, Peter Wiening, in 34th position overall.
Yes, 12 minutes down, so he's hanging in there well, considering, you know, what he went through on Etna. We see him, he had a very difficult day. We're hearing also Sastre having difficulty following in the main bunch.
...12 kilometres remaining of this climb, 20.7 kilometres, and doing a good job on the front here, Nivi. Not much sign of the... I haven't seen the white jersey yet. He's going to be there. He's going to be there, but we just don't see him. Might see him from the overhead shot here. White jersey, there he is, about 15 back. The sky... coloured shorts, sky blue shorts, we almost turquoise shorts, not to confuse them with Team Sky. The turquoise shorts of Astana and the white jersey of best young rider. Andrea Noe gets caught and passed. Arroyo looking very comfortable in third in this little line. Peter Wiening and Sarmiento are riding together with 12 kilometres to go, but they only have about 35, 36 seconds over the rest of the peloton. Soon, some of these cars are going to be going past them. The neutral car goes past. Peter Wiening looks up and looks back. There we are. It's exactly what happens, Sean, isn't it? When those cars start to pass you, you know that the rest of the boys are coming up on you very quickly.
Yes, not a good feeling at all. You know it's pretty much game over when you see the cars being pushed on, pushed past by the commissaire, and I think you have a feeling as well for quite a while, because the time gaps, you can't make the calculation. You hear, you know, through your race radio. Also, as you ride along here, you know, you have some of the motorbikes with you, and there is the radio on the motorbike, the loudspeaker, which gives, you know, the race radio. So you'd be hearing all the time, you know, the peloton chasing at such a time from the leaders on the road. So you're, you know, pretty much waiting for it to happen. But when it does happen, you could see Wiening there having to look over as some of the cars were made go by.
Wiening and Sarmiento. Sarmiento, who's ridden for Acquasapone for both years of his professional career. Like so many of the Colombians, he tends to do better in the hilly bits. Like so many of the Basques, Nieve does also. Winner of a stage last year. Solo mountain victory for him. And If they get the camera to stay still, you'll see Peter Wiening and Sarmiento here. 11.6 kilometers to go on this Grossglockner climb. Remember that the top is 7 kilometers from the top of the mountain's classification point. They're all strung out here, all the big favorites. The teammate of Mikhail Nieve and Igor Anton is just at the bottom of your shot now. Well, Wiening is in better shape again. He's had an impressive Giro d'Italia so far. He's clearly won a stage. He's got the pink jersey, which he defended quite well for a day or so.
Yes.
And he's up here again?
Yes, having a real good Giro. And I think the problem was down in Etna, the oven was too hot for him, and he suffered big time. Here today, you know, the cooler conditions, he seems to be, you know, riding well. And when you look at the company he's with, Sarmiento, a very good climber, and it's Wiening who is setting the pace here, so he seems to be back to his best. And unfortunately, they were never allowed to take the advantage. If they had, you know, got a big advantage here, well, then he could be contesting for a second stage victory. And if he, you know, if he managed to do that, well, what a race has been from already with a stage win and a number of days in the pink. But if he could win it, you know, a second stage in the Giro, that would have been a dream for him.
Yep, certainly would. I don't think it's going to happen though.
No, not going to happen now in the situation, because you know, the time advantage that they have and that they had coming into the climb was never going to be enough.
Pasquirelli in the colours of Astana with the ponytail out of the back. He's had a terrific ride here for Astana. Get that drum out of the way, sir. I can see Dario Cataldo towards the back of the group, the quick step rider. And riding on the wheel of Alberto Contador is Michele Scarponi on the right-hand side, and Vincenzo Nibali just behind him. Nibali himself says he's a steady rider, Sean. He's not an explosive rider. I think that'd be a fair assessment of his climbing capabilities.
Yes, certainly that's the way he climbs. And we see him last year in the Vuelta. You know, he was climbing at his pace, and he likes to climb at, you know, a steady, strong pace. None of this accelerating and sudden doping in speed. He doesn't like that at all. But very, very powerful. And that's the problem with Contador. When Contador goes in the attack, you know, he has that advantage that he can just explode with power and take, you know, 10, 15 bike lengths immediately. And there's a lot of good climbers can do that, but to keep it going then is a problem. And Contador is the one who can still, when he gets that 20, 30 metres advantage, he can still just keep on going.
Peter Wiening and Sarmiento on the left-hand side of your screen. I was wondering if they were keeping it that wide because the peloton's coming up quicker on them. But it doesn't appear to be the case at the moment. Yeah, it's Didi! Didi in pink! My word! Peter Wiening looks over his shoulder and goes, I know who you are. That's great. Hardly ever see Didi at the Giro d'Italia. Oh, Peter Wiening has gone. And Sarmiento is left by himself here with 10.5 kilometres to go. That's a bit strange. Didi bouncing around on the far side of the road there. Rujano. Little Jose Rujano, who attacked on Mount Etna. He is a man who can accelerate quite quickly. Rujano and Wiening looking back and waiting for the rest of the bunch here. And look at this. You got Anton of Euskaltel Euskadi now taking up the pace, going after Rujano. Rujano's on the right-hand side of the road. Sarmiento is still just ahead. Rujano looks over his shoulder. I don't think he'll dig again. I think he'll just wait for the other riders to come up to him, and he'll have another go perhaps a bit later on. You've got Anton as the man who's just increased the pace slightly to shut that down. Everybody else content to follow him. Sarmiento may not even be aware they're behind him. Looks over the shoulder, well, he is now. A Colombian at the front of the race, and then second, just upping the pace again here, Rujano, a Venezuelan. Well, he seems to be back in a good place again. Escarponi decides to accelerate. And Rujano maybe have somebody to work with now. Scarponi moving away on the right-hand side of the road. Igor Anton on his wheel. How long will the pink jersey of Alberto Contador leave Scarponi to go? He's looking over his shoulder. Not getting too much of a gap. The pace is still high enough to keep them within reach, Sean.
Yes, the pace is still good, and we can see there they're just pulling out very, very gradually, and Contador is just sitting on the Astana ready for the moment and allowing him to just make the pace on the front of the leading group of big favourites. And, you know, Contador, I think, you know, he's not in any difficulty, and just allow it to happen and wait and see what sort of a gap that Scarponi can pull out. And the bunch really has just exploded here. There's, you know, only about 12 or 15 riders in the chasing group with Contador and everybody else out the rear, which is surprising because they have been riding at a steadier pace here. They haven't been that, you know, sudden accelerations, which really puts riders under difficulty, but it is causing a lot of problems here, and we're going to see some of the favours we talked about, you know, showing that they're not really going to get a place here in this race, in the general classement, which they would have been thinking about this morning.
Maybe that is the case. Tsvitsu looks as though he is no longer in this group. Konstantin Tsvitsov, who is lying second on the general classification, looks as if he's not in this group to me, Sean. I can't see him at all at the moment, and that is a disaster for HTC High Road, having now wanted to focus their forces on him. They had Craig Lewis in the breakaway. Three men at the front of the race now. It's Jose Rujano, the little Venezuelan, riding for Androni. It's been said that perhaps Gianni Savio, his director sportif, said that when he came third in the Giro d'Italia a number of years ago, it wasn't actually very good for him. Went back home to Venezuela, and everybody went, wow, you're the next Venezuelan superstar, you can do anything. And lots of journalists ringing up and saying, when's he going to win the Tour de France? How many Tour de France is he going to win? All this type of stuff. And it went a bit to Rohanu's head. And he didn't manage to pull it off at all. He went to Quickstep for a while. He had the most bizarre time at Quickstep. I think it was in the Giro d'Italia, wasn't it, Sean? Where he just stopped on a mountain and he had the director sportif go up to him and say, you better get back on your bike and get down the mountain now, because I'm not having this.
Yes, it was in the Giro, but it was before he went to Quickstep, actually. There was an agreement with Patrick Lefebvre where he would ride up to Giro, and after that he was moving on to Quickstep to do the Tour of France, was on the programme. But he was not in agreement with Savio, and there was, you know, discussions going on, and I think it was very close to the finish one day at the top of a mountain. He decided he wanted to stop, and there was a lot of not good word spoke by Savio the way he was competing in that Giro, the final race for Savio's team.
I think actually he did the same thing the following year at Quickstep. He actually did stop. We didn't see it. I remember now, we didn't see it, and we were told on race radio he'd stopped in the middle of a mountain for some reason. Then he went to Case de Pank, did nothing really there. Gianni Savio has taken him back into the fold, and Androni in this. It is apparently he's back to his best. Look at this. Scarponi has been joined now with Rujano and Nibali and Contador. It's just hard pace riding here. Now the rest of the group beginning to come up to them. There's no massive explosive attacks yet, as it looks like Anton wants to go again on the far side of the road. We haven't seen the shot at the moment. Rujano is increasing his pace. And there is Anton, out of the saddle, just dancing around on the pedals. Lightly is Alberto Contador. Nibali, 1-1-1. Kreuzinger in the white jersey in the turquoise shorts. And there's a Geox rider in there as well. I haven't paid much attention to him. That in the number 81 there is Joaquim Rodriguez, suffering a little bit again. He has Jean Gadre for company, the winner of the stage the other day for the AG2R squad, and they are losing a little bit of ground on the top five men here. Oh. Now Alberto Contador lifts the pace. Will he lift it beyond anything anybody can stay with? He's not going for a huge attack yet, but he's just riding away, Sean. He's just riding away.
Yes, he certainly is, and difficult to calculate here. I think the gradient could be very steep, and yep. It looks like that he's not attacking. But Contador, when he's just out of the saddle and standing on the pedals, you know, it looked like he's not really giving an effort. But you can see Scarponi having difficulty keeping it going, and it is, you know, we can see here is a steep section, and there's riders just scattered everywhere for the moment. Little gaps between the riders, that tells us the gradient is quite severe.
Jose Rahano, once again, the only man who could stay with Alberto Contador at this point. So difficult to tell from the overhead shot, but it does rise to over 14% going up towards the top of the mountains classification point. Remember, there's another 7K after that. Contador looks over his shoulder to see who's with him, and Scarponi is the next best rider on the road, but looks almost pedestrian compared to the other two. 8K to go. They're almost to the top then of the mountains classification point. Scarponi will just be saying to himself, Sean, okay, I've got to keep it under control, limit my losses, and I can catch them on the flat.
Well, yes, sir. Just keep it close to the red zone, but not over or into it. And Scarponi, you know, he is a rider that we've seen in this Giro and in many races where he loses a little bit of ground but recovers quite well, and he also is deceiving. The gear he uses, he's turning a much bigger gear than Contador, so he gives the impression that he's going that bit slower. So for the moment he's doing a good job. It'll be interesting to see further down the other big favourites where they are, and you know, we can see there that Nibali was pretty good for a while but seemed to have, you know, lost a little bit of ground in the last moments.
Nibali and Kreuzinger both losing ground to Alberto Contador and Michele Scarponi at this point. Scarponi is now being joined here. It's Menchoff is the Geox rider. So Denis Menchoff makes his first appearance at the front of the race, Sean, and he's managed to stay with at least five or six riders, but way behind Alberto Contador in terms of pure speed. Contador's just ridden away from them at the moment. What is the question here? Are they riding for second? Who knows? I doubt if they even think that way, but surely it must play on your mind a little bit.
Well, for the moment, I think Menchoff following quite well. The question is, how good is he? Is he just following for the moment, playing the waiting game, or is he on the limit a bit and just hanging in here? And that's always difficult to know. And Menchoff is a one who follows very well. He can just follow for a long time. Still 7.5 kilometres to go. We'll have to see how Contador keeps it going up front. And it will be interesting because Contador, we know when he went away on Mount Etna, it was very impressive. But, you know, today is a different day and we might not see him as strong and dominant as he was on the day to Etna.
Contador led the general classification this morning. That's why he got the pink jersey on. Konstantin Svitsov, a big, big loser so far today. He started the day 59 seconds down. He's nowhere to be seen in these shots. Vincenzo Nibali at 1:22. Christophe Lemervel, not seen in the last 10 minutes or so. Scarponi, we've seen up there. Arroyo is up there. Kreuziger is up there. Serpa, haven't seen him either. It's very difficult to tell, though, because they could well just be out of our shot. Interesting to see who rejoins them, if anybody, on the descent. When they go over the top of this categorized section of the climb, there's a run downhill and then a flat. Jose Rujano looks to be one of the best climbers in this year's Giro d'Italia, but he is 6 minutes and 5 seconds down on the general classification. And unless he can do something spectacular in the mountains, sure, he's going to leapfrog a whole series of riders in the next two or three days if he can keep this form up. But even so, it'd be very, very difficult to challenge a Contador.
Yes, to challenge a Contador, certainly, because, you know, Contador is able to follow the attacks of Rugano. And when he went in the beginning, of course, Contador, you know, no panic at all, just allowed Rugano to have his time out front and then rise up to him when there's other favourites trying to go across. And we see the one which was Scapone, who tried to, you know, sneak away as such. And Contador wasn't having any of that. And it will be interesting to see. Contador is the one who is setting the most the pace at the moment, but Rugano have all to ride for. If they can pull away here, we could see Rugano taking the stage, because I don't think that Contador will contest the sprint if he try and or work with him. But again, this downhill section will be interesting, and also the conditions, as we can see here,
sketchy, you know,
sketchy at the moment, and everybody really throwing caution to the wind here. Nibali, we know in the descents he can go down that much better, but the cold, I think, is going to hit everybody here, and it's getting very cold, I imagine, out there now. So some of the riders just could have problems in the final kilometres with the cold just getting into them.
Let's see who has the bottle to go after. Alvaro Contador and Jose Rojano at this point. They've gone over the first category climb. We know who got those. It's between Contador and Rojano as to who went over the top first. We didn't actually see it. This is looking back at the point when Contador accelerated. Scarponi once again goes onto the wheel, but it was Rojano who has the acceleration. Scarponi, as you say, Sean, very, very deceptive. He turns a much bigger gear. Scarponi is not afraid of descending, and Vincenzo Nibali is going to be the one who could really, really do some damage on the descent, but none of them looking as though they want to at the moment. Nibali comes to the front. Arroyo looks over his shoulder to see who's there. Gadre has caught them, as is Matteo Carrara. That's great riding by Matteo Carrara. This is Mascherelli. He too is rejoining it. And it was the question we posed a little bit earlier on, Sean, was who will rejoin this group and what will it be like by the end of the day? Because although Alberto Contador has accelerated with Rojano and gone over the top of the mountain's classification point, another 7K to go.
Yes, and I'm not surprised that guys rejoining the leading group, because they're not riding the front at all. We see there that group of Nibali just looking at each other, and nobody wanted to take it up, and then Nibali decides just to keep it rolling on the front. So, you know, the out front here, they're definitely, you know, pulling out the advantage, because the chasers are just, you know, playing the tactical game, who's going to do the chasing here, and it's playing into the hands of Contador and Lugano at the moment.
Alberto Contador with Jose Rojano just sitting on his wheel, content not to really do a huge amount of work. He's done some turns on the front, but I'm not surprised he wants to sit there for a lot of the time. Come through and do a little now. I'm going to try and let Contador use as much energy as possible, and of course he remembers how much under the cosh he was with Contador on Mount Etna. Don't think he'll be there too long. He'll pull over, and Contador will come through and do his bid next. Well, it's a long road still to the finish, and as I say, at least they're going uphill now. A bit sketchy, this road surface. A lot of the roads around here, Sean, could be quite smooth, worn down. Get some water on them, they can be quite slippery.
Yes, and we could feel that with the riders. We see the Nibali group when they started to go downhill, and also Contador really just taking it slowly, and the riders are the ones who know. They can, you know, calculate very well, and we can also see from here the surface very smooth, and of course, you know, the rain just coming down, it's a dangerous point and a dangerous time, and you have to be really careful. Not a nice time to fall off, especially, you know, at this stage of the race, and if the body's a bit cold as well and you take a spill, very hard to get moving again at any time, and more so at this point in the race.
Alberto Contador is firmly stamping his authority once again on the Giro d'Italia. He has the pink jersey, he has the points jersey. He's going to get to the top of this, Sean, and I think he's going to earn the mountains classification jersey as well. It's very likely. The only jersey he can't qualify for is the best young rider's jersey. But this it really is a show of dominance.
Certainly is, and surprising here today that he went in the attack, and I thought he was going to just follow, and the real danger meant the Scarponis, the Nibali, for example, cruising, he was going to just stay with those guys today, but he was the one when Scarponi, put in the attack, reacted, left him right for a while, and then just, threw in another attack, and here he is riding very strongly out front, and just want to put more time into the big favourites, and today is the day where if the other favourites are going to have any chance with the cooler conditions, I don't think Contador is in his best in those conditions, but the other ones are not able to match his power and his climbing ability. And, Rugano again proving to be an exceptional climber when the day presents itself with a real difficult final, he's up there again.
Well, this is a display of power that almost leaves you speechless, thinking, what can anybody else do? The simple fact is that Jose Rojano, however well he climbs, is never going to challenge Alberto Contador for the overall classification unless something drastic happens to Contador. He simply can't ride a time trial bark fast enough. Although this year we have a mountain time trial, which may play into his hands. Now John Gadre, trying hard. But I just can't see on this form, Sean, on this particular mountain, it's certainly not the hardest because they've got them to come tomorrow. I just cannot see who can challenge Alberto Contador for the win of this Giro d'Italia.
Well, looking more and more unlikely, we'll see anybody really challenging him, because first day okay, Etna, very warm conditions, first day in the mountains. Riders need a bit of time to get into the rhythm of the climbing, but here again, second day, second opportunity for some of the bigger favourites to try and challenge Contador, but not up to it at all. When Contador goes, there was Nibali, Cruisinger, very disappointing, for example. Scarponi is the only one who, he does try and go in the attack, but when Contador really puts on the pressure, not able to follow in the wheel of Alberto Contador.
Extraordinary performance. 3 kilometres to go, and the two men out ahead are Jose Rojano of Androni, the little Venezuelan climber, and Alberto Contador. Well, what can you say about this man? Always lurking in the back of your mind. You just wonder what's going to happen. What would happen? It's a horrible thing to say, but what would happen if the Court of Arbitration for Sport said, sorry, Bertie, you're not racing anymore?
And two chasers now with Gadre. He's joined by a teammate.
Mascherelli is the man doing the work once again for Roman Kreuziger, the Czech rider being led by the Italian there. Vincenzo Nibali looks cold, as does Scarponi. They're just doing what they have to do. They can do absolutely no more. Joaquim Rodriguez joins them. And there is Denis Menchov, number 61. David Arroyo, 1-2-1. The man from Rabobank is in this group, is Steven Kreuzweig again. Steven Kreuzweig, the young rider, very, very talented. And Gadre. Well, Gadre is a contender for a podium, If he can continue to climb throughout the next 2 or 3 days. Gadre is only, 2.5 minutes down on the general classification? 2:35, I think he is. And Gadre has already won a stage in this year's Giro and really is known as a climber, but he's picking his times with interest, Sean, as to how he attacks. He attacks at exactly the right time of the day, but I'm not sure that today it's been quite the right time, as Igor Anton decides now. Time to go, got to do something. I'm afraid to say it looks to me as though they're all looking at putting time into each other now rather than attacking Contador. Sad but true. 2.3 kilometres to go then, and Igor Anton, the man who held the red jersey, the leader's jersey in the Vuelta a España last year till he fell off in spectacular style in a mid-road crash, at speed, and it was all the favourites that were involved in that particular group, and he was the one that fell. Splitting asunder here, Sean, some of these other riders, they are just beginning to tail off.
Yes, I think everybody is really on the limit, and a lot of the riders are suffering from the cold here. You can see, you know, the way they're looking, and when you you know, get cold on a climb, it's so difficult, you cannot go at your best at all, and it's just a struggle here, a fight to get to the finish with a lot of the favourites there. We can see there's, you know, Nibali, Scarponi looking just in real difficulty, and just hoping to get the finish here and get this day over with.
I wonder what is going through the mind of Vincenzo Nibali and Michele Scarponi and Romain Koisinger. Not a nice day, cold, wet. They're being absolutely mullered by that man there at the back of our shot. Alberto Contador's got Jose Rojano with him. It is a rising ramp up to the top again now, with 1.5 kilometers to go, and Gadre is giving it everything he can to try and take some comfort out of this. He will move up in the mountains classification as well, of course, Jean Gadre. But he's surprisingly strong. He's always been a good climber, but at 2 minutes and 35 seconds down, Sean, he seems to be about one of the only men who can do. Whoa, massive acceleration from Joaquim Rodriguez with 1.5 kilometers to go. Well, if you can do that now, why can you do it earlier? Is the question. When it counts, when it counted. Alberto Contador sitting in the wheel of the little Venezuelan Rojano, and although Gadre is giving it everything, he's not actually pulling away too much now. Others are beginning to eat up into that gap that he's put into them. And now Alberto gets to the front. Is he going to turn the tap on? With 1.2 kilometers to go, Rojano is going to have to grip those bars super hard, grit his teeth, and think, what do we do this time? He's going to try and out-sprint him as they come into the final kilometer. The pink jersey of Alberto Contador has shown he is the strongest rider in this year's Giro d'Italia, bar none. Gadre rapidly running out of energy. Contador continues to drive towards the line. Rojano this time, will he get past him? Contador won't be particularly worried if he does. He'd like the stage win, but Rojano would like to exact some sort of revenge for the other day. He's managed to stay on his wheel this time around. Looks over his shoulder to see where Rojano is. Into the last kilometer, 900 meters to go. A word or two passing between them, both Spanish speakers, of course. And the Venezuelan, who Gianni Savio says he's back to his best now, certainly showing that he is a climber to really be contended with. Whether he can do anything in this Giro d'Italia and move up, he has got a third place overall many years ago now, we don't know. He'll be very, very happy if he can take a stage win. That would be a start. He showed he can stick with Alberto Contador at most times, but on the Etna the other day, even he was blown away. 500 meters to go. Gets down on the drops. He's getting ready for it. They both are. This is going to be interesting. Contador time trialing his way over the last 250 meters here. Got to stay upright, that's the main thing. It's a little bit drier here. Racing side by side. Who's going to open up the sprint here? The Venezuelan comes up the inside and looks over his shoulder. Is Contador going to leave him have it? Yes, he is. Jose Rojano takes the stage win. Alberto Contador content with second place and putting a great amount of time into his rivals. I've got 5 seconds on the clock already. Now it's 10 as Gadre comes up. Igor Anton, that's 15. Anton is just behind him. Well, Gadre has tried, but he's not going to get something out of this today. Maybe a third point, third place if he's lucky. We're coming up to 30 seconds I have on the clock now. Gadre is going to take third then with Igor Anton charging at him. Oh, he's going to put well over a minute. He's going to put nearly a minute, Sean, into his main rivals, is Alberto Contador. It's already up to about 50 seconds. 55. We've got the clock in the corner now, so I was a little bit out on that as well. Well over a minute then put into the main rivals. I think it's game over unless something happens to Contador. Unless they work together, unless they really attack him, unless he just gets done over time and time and time again by some sort of alliance, he's going to win this Giro.
Yes, well, it's difficult to see how they're going to beat him, and unless there is a breakaway where some of the, you know, the further down riders cause a lot of problems and he gets a difficult day in a straight-out mountaintop finish, it's not going to happen.
Igor Anton comes over the line. The sprint from the other big favourites, Roman Koisinger, Scarponi, Nibali. I think Kirienka was in that group as well. That's fantastic riding by Kirienka to make that group. When will they give him the chance to lead a team, one wonders. Vasily Kirienka. Well, the Grossglockner, the first of three massive days in the mountains, as Matteo Carrara comes over the line, has been the day of Alberto Contador. Some of the names who featured prominently in the Giro so far, nowhere to be seen. We can't see Jose Serpa. He certainly hasn't been up towards the front. This could be Serpa here, of course, in this group, but nowhere near the top of the order today, and that'll be disappointing for him. Thiago Mercado is the Radio Shack rider at the back. Other riders, we haven't seen Emanuele Sella. Not featuring Konstantin Svitsov. We haven't seen him at all come over. Christophe Lemervel not there. Cataldo has gone. I tried to keep the pace of Alberto, says Vincenzo. It's absolutely impossible to attack him. Yep, we can see that. Here is Christophe Lemervel with Stefano Garzelli in the group that's coming up. There's Jose Serpa. Minutes and 15 seconds lost to Alberto Contador today. Well, what a display of power by Contador. It was a hard, hard mountain. Thomas Lukvist coming in here, Dario Cioni, both of Sky. Christophe Lemervel goes through your shot now. He said the other day that he had to be very, very lucky to do much more in these very high mountains. It wasn't going to be his time. Big loser today, Sean, Konstantin Svitsov.
Yes, big time. And also we have seen Serpa, who lost a bit of time there, who would be expecting maybe to be up in it. We're seeing a bit more light between the big favourites now. And I think today it will give us a clearer picture who is capable of, you know, staying up and getting into the podium places in this Giro.
Well, if Jose Rojano can climb like he has been over the last couple of days, then maybe he is in contention for a podium place, Sean, as is Jean Gadre. Gadre was 2 minutes and 35 seconds down, and Rojano was over 6 minutes down, but he's gained 3 minutes on most of his rivals. Well, it's almost slightly depressing, really, isn't it? You think the man Alberto Contador is just so head and shoulders above everybody else. I wonder who can challenge him. But bike racing is bike racing. Anything can happen. It will only take maybe one mistake, one crash for Alberto Contador, one puncture at an untimely moment with no team around him and others to attack him. And the thing could turn on its head once again. We've seen things happen to Alberto Contador before. We've seen in the Paris-Nice race, for example, where he completely ran out of food, real schoolboy error, and the slowest rulers in the peloton, the biggest elephants on bikes, were going past him on the last hill of the day. It was just incredible to watch. So things can happen, but at the moment, Sean, it's looking a lot like a Contador race, this.
Yes, well, again today he just gives the demonstration that we knew was very possible from a Contador, but I was expecting to see the bigger favourites to be more in there on the battle today and give him a little bit of a more of a challenge, but unfortunately no, and now it looks, you know, highly unlikely that we can see anybody challenging Contador.
Svitzov slips from second to sixth today. Vincenzo Nibali moves up to second spot, but he's over 3 minutes down on the leader, Alberto Contador. Christophe Lemervel, big loser, 16th now, 5 minutes 29 down. Joaquim Rodriguez, also a loser, 5:26. Cataldo hanging in there. Kirienka, 5:08. Kirienka deserves more as a rider, deserves more as a leader. But the day belongs once again to Alberto Contador, even if the stage today went to Venezuela's José Rojano. As Bram Tankink has been just increasingly getting better and better in his performances over the last 2 years or so. He shed a lot of weight at the start of the season 2 years ago. Definitely leaned up. And his performances have been very consistent and very good. Marco Silvaggi taking off the rain jacket, or the gilet. It's certainly not been the warmest of days to start. There were a lot of rain jackets about, Sean, on the mountains a little bit earlier. They won't have time to worry about that by the time they get to Zoncolan. They'll be wanting to shed as much as possible, I would imagine.
Yes, well, they'll be shedding everything they can before they get to the Zoncolan to be as lightweight as possible, as you said. But today is a day where we can see it's cloudy, the risk of shower is always there. And in the opening of a programme, we see inside the Astana, Martinelli giving out these bottles with rain jackets in them. I don't know what's that all about, because normally you just put the rain jacket in your pocket and on you go, and it's, you know, they fold up so neatly, the rain jackets, you don't even feel it in the back of your centre pocket of your jersey. And it's the way to do it, you know, just put it in your pocket, leave it there for most of the day, and as you get to the final, you give it to a teammate or you throw it to a spectator, because within the teams they have plenty of reserve of all of the clothing, rain jackets, and it's not going to be a problem.
The size of the chainring there, the tiny, tiny chainring on the bike. Some of the riders using very, very small chainrings, less than 34 teeth on the inside, and massive great dinner plates of sprockets at the back for the climb of the Zoncolan today. Real mountain bike stuff. Not that many, if I can think of any actually, triples. But the ability to mix and match group sets now, Sean, or the elements within particular companies' group sets is phenomenal, isn't it? I mean, you could put mountain bike gearing on road bikes, you could, with some modification, you could put great big sprockets on, you could put long cage derailleurs on. People often do. You buy them with long cage derailleurs. It's just the interchangeability is extraordinary now.
Yes. the long cage derailleur, of course, you can have a huge sprocket on the rear. And so the possibilities are there, and if you go back 25 years ago, you had major difficulty in the mountain stages. The difference between each sprocket, sometimes it jumped, two and three sprockets when you got close to your climbing sprocket. So, now they have, magnificent ratio of gearing, and even for a stage like today, you still have a good ratio for the flat sections. And also for the real steep gradient of the climb, you have sufficient gear, low enough gearing.
Well, the weather, as you say, been particularly kind. Actually, it wasn't very nice at the top of Zoncolan earlier today, but it seems to be going okay now. What have the Italian press been saying about yesterday's finish at? That just saw Alberto Contador and Rujano finishing together at Grossglockner. Well, they, every day they give a bit of a league table, and marks out of 10. Alberto Contador getting a 9 out of a 10 for his aggressive behaviour, being able to ride everybody off of the wheel. Rujano getting an 8.5. I'm not quite sure why he's just getting an 8.5. It doesn't really explain why he gets half a point less than Alberto Contador, but he does. Igor Anton, 7.5 out of 10 for his brave efforts to get away and showing that he's at least willing to try and make some sort of fight out of it. Mascherelli, Beppe Mascherelli, as he's known in the press, certainly getting his justified 7. He's worked very, very hard, not only for Kreuzinger, but he's climbing well himself. Carrara, 6.5. Well, he came from pretty much nowhere to appear in our screens. Disappointing points, though, for Scarponi, Nibali and Sastra. Sastra only getting 4 out of 10. Well, we didn't even see Sastra, but saw Menchov. We hardly saw Sastra at all. We didn't see Sastra on the climb whatsoever. Nibali getting a 5, Scarponi getting 5.5. Basically, they're saying they don't seem to want to be able to push themselves on and challenge. Even though Scarponi gave it a little bit of an acceleration to try and get away, it was almost half-hearted, says the Italian press. The mountain gets 6.5 out of 10 and wasn't even in their last kilometre or two, or even 5 kilometres. Andrea Noe, 42 years of age, gets 6.5 out of 10 for being in the breakaway. But it's the last we'll see of Andrea Noe in this year's Giro d'Italia because he has abandoned today. Number 157, Andrea Noe at 42 years of age, abandoning the stage 14 today. Abandons yesterday Sasha Modolo and Gerald Cirlec, two more sprinters gone. The list of riders gone completely now from the Giro d'Italia. Napolitano went in stage 11. Jackson Rodriguez, stage 8. Chris Barton didn't finish stage 5. Kohler abandoned yesterday on stage 13. Chris Butler, thanks to a hairline fracture, didn't start on stage 9. Belletti and Modolo both out on stage 13. Belletti didn't start. And Sasha Modolo abandoned. Duarte out pretty early-ish, stage 8. Cavendish on 13, as well as Renshaw. They both didn't start. Neither did Pataki or Honda. Noe, we've just said, abandoned today. Fiali, his teammate, didn't finish stage 5. That's the stage with the Strada Bianchi in it. Adam Blythe didn't start stage 10. Ventoso didn't start yesterday. Another sprinter not to. Graham Brown and Robbie McEwen both eliminated on Etna on stage 9. And Tom Slagter, now at home in the Netherlands recuperating, didn't finish stage 5 after the horrible crash. The only other abandons then associated with the tragic death of Wouter Veyland, the whole of the Leopard Trek team, and Tyler Farah from Garmin Cervelo. There's Rabotini at the back, just hopping the bike a bit. Brambilla, Rabotini and Tankink in the break here. Rabotini a winner in a stage in the Tour of Turkey this year. Brambilla has already worn the Mountains classification jersey in this year's Giro d'Italia. And Bram Tankink, well, wearing the points jersey in the Tour of Romandy did him no harm whatsoever. Nine minutes and 6 seconds with 63 kilometres to go is not going to be enough to win on the Zoncolan, but we may see them out there for just a little bit in glory before the rest of the peloton and the big favourites arrive. It's a nice bit of a descent. Wide enough to be entertaining. Twisty enough to keep you on your toes. Contador waiting for his car to come up to talk to, but you have to say, Sean, I can't. Are you finding it a little disappointing this year in Italia in the sense that there doesn't seem to be any real competition for Alberto Contador, or is it this are you in awe of his ability to ride away from everybody? What's your personal opinion as a winner of a Grand Tour yourself?
Well, coming into this Giro, I was expecting, you know, a bigger fight from Nibali, considering last year he was, you know, so impressive in the Vuelta. Scarponi, we've seen him this year. He's been very good shape, and also I was expecting, you know, something from him. More from him up to this moment. I don't think he has, you know, shows a lot. And Cruisinger, as we see, Contador going for a bike change. And he's doing this a lot in the last couple of days. He seemed to change the bike every day. I was reading in one of the papers that he changed yesterday again, and the day to Etna he also changed. So he seemed to have you know, this bike especially for the final, and he makes the change every day when it's the mountaintop finish.
Why would you do that these days, Sean? Because, I mean, surely it's certainly in the past when there weren't weight restrictions on bikes, where the UCI didn't have the 6.8 kilo rule, you could see why they might change bikes. They might change for a lighter frame, lighter wheels, different geometry, whatever. Why would you bother doing it now?
Well, that's an interesting one, because the bikes are so lightweight now. They're at the minimum, or very close to the minimum, which is, you know, the UCI regulation, where in the past, 15, 20 years ago, it wasn't the case. Maybe he's got a motor in there and the battery goes low about the halfway point, so he has to just get on a new bike and new batteries.
Very possible. Very possible. Well, Cesato's doing a lot of pace hitting. Sitting on the front, plugging away. Here comes Alberto.
Cesato doing a really good job. The past days we've seen him there on the front riding a lot, and you know, riding up some of the mountains, and we see in the rear end riders having difficulty following. It's something new from Passato, because when he was with Quickstep, for example, he was, you know, doing a totally different role, different job, where he was leading out the sprints for the likes of Tom Bowen, and whoever the sprint of the Quickstep was in that race. He seemed to have changed, and it's amazing, Barn Rees, he can, you know, just change the minds of the riders and you know, focus them. And Tozato is, he's a class rider. We have to, you know, take your hat off there and say that. And the mentality has probably changed now. He knows that there's nothing to do in the sprints, so he just rides in the front there and doing a magnificent job in this Giro so far.
Joking aside, it'd be interesting to know why he changed his bike. This is a lovely descent. He's sweeping. 9 minutes and 12 seconds is the gap. Just coming down little by little by little. So Tozzato and crew doing a good job. Just plugging away, bringing it back a little bit. Is it, to some of the componentry that you put on a modern bike make a big difference in climbing now, Sean? I mean, the big thing in the past would have been wheel sets, whether you'd have lighter wheels for climbing, special wheels built for climbing. Often people did have special wheels just built for climbing, and they would take a bike with those on at a big mountaintop finish. But nowadays, does it make so much, that much difference?
Well, the weight, it always makes a difference, but I don't think there's any great difference in the between the normal bike you use and if you're talking maybe having a climbing bike. I don't see where you can have the gain the weight advantage, because the wheels, they're all so lightweight now and all so good that you know, you can ride all the time in a 3 week race with the same wheels, and they are just, you know, real lightweight, where again 20 years ago the normal wheels were that much heavier, so you could put on a lighter pair of wheels, less number of spokes, or with a special block, a lightweight block on the rear. But you know, it's surprising to see Contador change the bike. I just no idea what the reason is, because the bike is, the normal bike that you ride every day is so light, it's difficult to see you know, to the reason to change the bike, because you cannot go any lighter.
No, you can't go any lighter, full stop. 6.8 kilos is the UCI regulation minimum weight, so it could be about weight distribution, could be about, possibly feels that the if you're turning a heavy set of wheels, if you're turning them over, doesn't allow you to accelerate to do that little jump dancing on the pedals perhaps as much as if you have a lighter set of wheels and perhaps you redistribute the weight somewhere else. It's all about the ability to accelerate. Could be just psychological. Could be just something where he thinks, right, that's it. You know, I don't feel something a little bit wrong. I don't feel quite comfortable on this. I'm going to have to change it. And then that settles his mind a little bit. I don't know. Very strange. Here's our 3 men in the break then. 9:23 is the gap with 58 kilometers to go. There's Rabotini closest to you. 24 years of age, the Farnese Vini rider. Behind him is Brambilla, former wearer of the green jersey here in the Giro d'Italia, not a winner of it. And Bram Tankink right at the back in the moment. It's possible, as a lot of people are suggesting, that perhaps the gear ratios are slightly different on the new bike than the one he's been riding before, preparing for the Zoncolan. That's possible. He could have a different setup in terms of gear ratio. That's true. Most likely explanation, actually. He just feels as though he had to have a bike set up better for later on, but then preferred the gear ratios closer together in a more standard pattern for earlier on in the race when there weren't the demands of the Monte Zoncolan. 9:28, 57 kilometers to go, and the sun is now shining on the Giro d'Italia. Under 55 kilometres to go now, and the Zoncolan is looming up for the last 10 of them. With a gap of 9:35 over our three breakaway men, who are never really going to stay away, Saxo Bank have just been content to set the pace at the front all day, and everybody else has been content to sit behind them, which is fair enough. We have a lot of time on our hands until then, so quick mention for the Gran Corsa d'Italia, being run in association with the prostate cancer charity and Sharp Electronics. Starts on the 29th of May and runs to the 20th of June. It takes in all the stages of this year's Giro d'Italia, people raising money for charity, of course. You can do as many as you like. You can join it when you like, and you can disappear when you like. And I think most of the places are filled. But I do know one person, at least, Peter McSharry, who's going to ride every single stage. More fool her, one says, looking at all these. I wonder if they'll put the Monte Crostis in. I'm not at all sure they will now. But you've either got to be slightly bonkers or as hard as nails to ride all this route. That's starting on the 29th of May, going through to the 20th of June. How do you fancy doing a 3-week sportive, Sean, following this route?
Jesus.
You're thinking about what to say then, weren't you, really?
Yes, I was just caught for words. And yes, to do a 3-week sportive, I don't know why people could do that, how they could do it. But again, you know, some people like to go out there and get the feeling of riding 3 weeks. But to do it on this Giro with the difficulty of it this year, it's a big demand. And when you look at the stages here, you know, today's stage, for example, it was to be 2:10. The riders, you calculate that is going to take him, you know, 6 hours if they were going over all the climbs. And what would it take a group of more leisure cyclists? It would probably take 10 hours. So if you take, you know, 3 weeks of riding your bike in days of 10 hours, it's, you know, a huge, huge challenge. But, you know, chapeau to them, the people that want to go out and do it. Why not, if it's, you know, if it's something you like doing? But I certainly, there is no way I would ever dream of going and doing a 3-week sportive.
And tomorrow it's the Novicole. Sunday 22nd of May, that's the essentially the etap of the Giro d'Italia.
Yes, and another one which gets big numbers, difficult, a difficult route. In the past years it has been really difficult, and you know, 10,000 plus, I think, you know, take the start, and these sportives, you know, all across Europe. They're just growing all the time, and the big ones like this, the Etape Two, the Novocoli, the numbers they get is, you know, extraordinary.
The Novocoli is actually a grand fondo. There's a race within it as well. It's not like British Sportives, for example. Interestingly, a journalist friend of mine, Adam Tranter, sent a tweet around yesterday. I noticed a lot of people now, there's a book been published about training for sportives, which does refer to them as competitions. You've got to remember, guys, wherever you're out there, it's not, sportives are not competitions. They're legally not competitions. You can't get the insurance to race. You have to be, it's come to a completely different set of insurance. So all sportives are challenge rides, and they're all personal challenges, but they are not races. It's as simple as that. However, on the continent, things like the Grand Fondos, for example, Sean, they really are races. They have races within them.
Yes, that is true. And, the road closure and that, it's all there as is for a normal race. And there is, I'm a little bit confused about sportives, because we have this, the Hibernia Sky one back in Ireland last year, which is in August, and that one was totally closed roads, and, it was a race. So I don't know what really defines exactly, is it just the road closure? Or is it, the timing? But a lot of the sportives, you get a timing chip, and people seem to think if you get a timing chip, it's a race, but it's not always the case. And of course, the road closure is very important. That is the safety part of it. You always have to be careful.
I'm sure that there are sportive organisers out there. Maybe if Lou's listening from the Dragon Ride, or anybody who's listening from big sportives will tell us. But as far as I'm aware, it's the insurance category. You have to get a BC license to run it, and you have to be insured to race, as opposed to just insured to compete, insured to take part, as opposed to competing. Might be different in Ireland, of course.
Yes, and if you get the insurance, to get the insurance and get the permission from the Federation, if it's from British Cycling or from Cycling Ireland, I suppose the insurance part is the thing that they require, that you have all in situ before you're granted that event. And a lot of the sportives, of course, they're very well organised, but, road closure and... It's something is very important. And this year we had, of course, the Tour, the Paris-Roubaix Sportive, which was the first time organised by ASO. That was supposed to be a road closure as well, but it changed because ASO couldn't get the permission to get full road closure. So the chip, your timing chip, was taking from you, and it was just more of a leisure event.
These are our three breakaway men, tanking at the front. In the middle, it's Rabotini, and at the back, Brambilla. Took them 30k to get away from the peloton, but since then, they have been away working together. They got a quick lead of about 10 minutes. It rose to nearly 11 minutes maximum, and now they're down to 9:22 as Saxo Bank continue to set the pace on the front. We're approaching the Monte Zoncolan today. If you're just joining us and you haven't heard the news about the Monte Crostis, it is not in the race today. Under the influence, shall we say, or the request of the team managers, Director Sportives, they have decided that it's not safe either for riders or for themselves as team staff to go up and over, and have asked for it to be removed, and they have done so. So the finish will be on Monte Zoncolan without the Crostis beforehand. .23 is the gap. A couple of books I could just quickly recommend while we're here, and a couple of people have mentioned them as well on the forums. There was a time when there weren't any decent books about the Giro and Italian cycling in general printed in English at all. There's two come out this year to coincide, I guess, with the 150th anniversary of unification. One is by Herbie Sykes, who wrote the great biography of Franco Balmamian called Eagle of the Canavesi. It's called Maglia Rosa. It's published by Ruler Books, and Herbie's done a pretty comprehensive job of looking at the history of the Giro d'Italia. The other one is a more general history of Italian cycling by John Foote. It's called Pedalare, Pedalare. And is eminently readable. Both of which I've started, I confess, to not having finished them yet. They're both fairly, well, certainly the Maglia Rosa is a fairly weighty tome. And Pedalare, Pedalare, I was reading the other night. Again, I'm about halfway through it. Good page-turning read. There are, of course, numerous books on the Tour de France and one comprehensive book on the Vuelta a España, although it's rather chronological in the way it's laid out. It's called Viva la Vuelta. So we dip under the 50k to go mark. Tank is beginning to blow a little bit, thinking, right, it's a long day in the saddle. And I wonder what they're just thinking now, thinking we've still got 50k to go and the Zoncolan to face. And good job setting the pace on the front, though, is Tank Inc. Rabotini took the intermediate sprint ahead of Tank Inc. and Brambilla. Rather close, that motorcycle. Giving him a nice little tow. I wonder what goes through your mind, Sean, if you are a rider like a Tank Inc., knowing that the peloton are going to come up to you, but you've got that Zoncolan to face all by yourself. Well, we'll discuss that when we get back from a commercial break. 9:25 is the gap, 48.7 is the distance. This is one of the stages that will be covered in the Gran Corsa Italia, which is starting at the end of next week. Good luck to all those taking part, especially my friend Peter. Just seems like a slightly foolhardy thing to do, ride the entire Giro d'Italia route, but fantastic. I think possibly she might be making a program for Sky about it, which is good. But better get that confirmed. I think that's what was on the cards. 47.7 kilometres to go. There's some pretty hard sportives around the world. There's some pretty hard sportives around the UK as well. The Fred Whitten was not too long ago. That's pretty nasty, especially as the major climbs come after 80 miles. These three men working quite well together, Sean. They are plugging along at a decent pace because although Saxo Bank have brought the gap down, they're still 9 minutes or so out there. I mean, it's going to be difficult for them to stay out at all, but even so, I think they're going quite well.
Yes, they're still working well, and we could see Tank Inc. there just pushing it on. I think they're getting a little bit more open the pace a bit and getting into it a bit more, and it's coming to that point now. If they can hold that 9 minutes and to the bottom of the climb, the final climb of the day, well then they should be able to go a good bit into the final. But again, will it be enough? 9 minutes, you would say it should be, but I would see it being difficult. It depends on what happened as well back in the bunch. If they really go racing in the earlier part of the Zoncolan, well then that gap will come down real, real quickly. But we can see they're pulling well together, and it's all to go for. There's nothing to lose here. They're committed themselves out here all day. I suppose one thing they would prefer if they were allowed 15 or 20 minutes in advantage, and then they would have a much better chance of going on. But unfortunately, the Saxo Banks are continuing making a good pace, and that 10 minutes, a bit over 10 minutes, was the maximum they were allowed.
We mentioned that the Italian press are giving their point scores for riders involved in yesterday's finish at Grossglockner. What have the French press got to say about yesterday's performance by Alberto Contador and José Rojano?
Well, Lugano, of course, they talk about him, and we mentioned that he had some good seasons and then had a lot of a lot of years where he was, you know, doing nothing, and we did, you know, hear Savio talking as well that he was about his team, and Rugano was one of the ones he said he's back to his good times, and he certainly is. So, you know, he was in the it was in the Tour of Italy 205, and that's when he was had the good years, and then seemed to go away and didn't do an awful lot since, but. Certainly, you know, the last days, the mountaintop finish is very much up there. It'll be interesting to see how far he can move up in the general classification in this Tour of Italy. Can he get on the podium? The other one is the AG2R performance, I suppose. Again, we see a good performance, you know, by the riders, and I suppose the one that really, you know, surprised me yesterday was Hubert Dupont, who finished fourth in the stage. A rider, you know, 30 years of age, he never won a race, and you know, he's had taken part in seven big tours, never abandoned one, but you know, a really great performance yesterday. And Galdery, of course, confirming his good form at the moment, and again, he's the one who is moving up the general classification. Will he be able to get on a podium in this Giro? I think it is possible, because looking at him yesterday, you know, he rode away from the other big favourites, and the Italians weren't, you know, able to follow at all. If he can continue on doing that with all the mountaintop finishes we've come on, very possible that we could see him on the podium.
Other teams beginning to take an interest in work at the front here. Valerio Agnoli is the liquid gas rider, setting the pace at the front now. Konovalovas is the first of the riders for Movistar's Totsato, moves up again for Saxo Bank. Let's just dwell a little bit on that AG2R performance yesterday, Sean. Herbert Dupont and Jean Guédry both going off, but going off separately. I mean, what's going on there? First of all, what do the French press make of it? And what do you make of it?
Well, I think it was just the steepness of the climb, and Hubert Dupont, he was in difficulty earlier on, and then he got back into that group of big favourites, and he just said he felt that, you know, he could get out of that group, and he said, why not attack, nothing to lose, and off he went. And Gadre was, you know, there as well, so the two of them were together for a moment, but then they seemed to be riding 50 metres apart in the final. But I think, you know, they were just on the limit. Everybody was giving it their 100%, and when you lose 10 bike lengths, it comes 20 bike lengths, and you just keep on fighting. I don't think it was a bit of rivalry between them, it's just the circumstances of the steepness of the gradient in the final kilometres.
Six kilometres to go. It'll be interesting to see if Dupont and Gadre can move up. If they do move up further after the Zoncolan, then this will be one of the best results for AG2R in terms of team performance for a long time. Dupont and Gadre are both in the top 10 at the moment. Do you think they can stay in there, Sean, when you've got riders like Rodriguez and Maschiarelli, Rujano, who are probably capable of moving up the order more today than maybe Dupont is?
Well, I think Dupont is going to be difficult for him. He had a super day yesterday, that is to say, in cycling terms, and I cannot see that continuing right through this final week of Giro. Gadre, yes, we've seen him in the past in the Giro. He can, you know, be present every day there, and I think he's the one. Will be the AG2R man with a possibility of getting onto the podium. And if he does get onto the podium, well then, although the Tour of France, he said that he's not really interested in the Tour of France after he won the stage a number of days ago. I was reading that he said the Tour of France, it wasn't, you know, the most important thing on his mind at the moment if he wasn't going to it. But I think it could change very quickly. If he sees he can do a place in the podium top three in the Tour of Italy, then he could, you know, start thinking about the Tour of France. And we could see a little bit of rivalry there coming back, which we see last year with Nicholas Roach, because they
had
little bit of a difficult time when Roach had a puncture at a vital moment when he was by far the best man in the AGR team, and Gadre rode by and never gave or never offered his wheel.
Yep, Nico wasn't very happy about that and made it quite public he wasn't very happy about that, and I'm sure I wouldn't have been either if I'd have been the leader of the AG2R team in the best place. But Gadre is in a very good position at the moment here in the Giro d'Italia. Let's assume that he does get a very high place here in the Giro. The pressure will be on him back in France to perform, and that's another thing that he'll have to think about very, very carefully. He might think, yeah, I could do something, but the amount of media pressure that will come on it will be tremendous.
Yes, well, first of all, I think, the decision will have to be made. Is he going to go to the Tour of France? Will the team send him to the France, or will they play just the card of Nicholas Roach as the general classification rider? And that is quite possible, considering this race is so difficult, and again this final week is going to be majorly energy sapping for the riders. And I think a rider like Galdray, if he really battles for a place on the podium general classification, I don't think for the Tour of France he would be in a position to go on. He's not that style of rider. He's not solid enough to do two big tours, and I think he would pay if he went to the Tour of France after, putting in such a difficult Giro.
It's Laurent Didier who's coming to the front for Saxo Bank to start upping the pace. I know Richie Porte just sitting on his wheel to try and gradually increase the tempo. Interesting to see Liquigas coming through and doing a little bit on the front as well. I think probably just going through that village, trying to keep everybody up in a decent position. Saxo Bank back on the front again doing the work, but it won't be long now before we see other teams beginning to join Saxo's at the front. They're going to have to do something, Sean. I mean, if Saxo Bank control this all the way to the bottom of the Zoncolan, then that's over for the day.
Yes, it's over for the day. Except for the stage victory, and if Contador wants to go on again and contest for the stage win or take time from his general classification rider as well, it's difficult to see anybody challenge him. And it looking like that we're going to see a situation where the Saxo Banks are going to control. I can't see, when you look at the route and the profile of the route at the moment, it doesn't look like there's an opportunity for the teams to do anything before we get to the bottom of the Zoncolan.
So really it'll be about just protecting your riders till you get there, and then just let them go, wind them up, let them go, see what they can do. We've still got a bit of time, 44.8 kilometres to go. Spartacus, you can't have my job. It's not going to happen. Greetings to everybody in Isla. Hope everybody's well. I was going to say the ride of the falling rain. Nice little sportive up in Isla in August, I think it's this year. If you've got any sportives in and around Europe and the UK and you just want to send me a tweet, I'll retweet them for you, which would be nice. 44k to go, and Rabottini had a good day today. Farnese Vini have been, actually, I'm quite glad that both of these teams have been out for a lot of their national tour. Farnese Vini and Colnago CSF have done a lot to push themselves forward, not necessarily been stage winners, but they've been present all the time. They've had jerseys on shoulders and so forth, which is good. Wide corners, no real fireworks yet. It's just one of those days, a long day with just one focal point at the end, the Monte Zoncolan. It would have been a little bit different if you're just joining us live here on stage 14 of the Giro d'Italia. The big news is on the stage anyway that the ascent and descent of Monte Crossis is no longer in this tour. $43k, and the Zoncolan is the finish today. Just getting some information on race radio about Twalis, which was put in. I just have to, sorry, I had stopped in the middle of the commentary then. It's probably a good thing, a lot of you say. But Race Radio was just telling us a bit of information about today's parkour. If you're just joining us, it was meant to include the Monte Crostis for the first time today, but they have taken it out under the pressure of the teams, and the Commissars made the decision to take out the Monte Crostis descent. Having seen the pictures of it today on our live on our screens, if you were with us earlier, you will see why. Very, very narrow, pretty dangerous. They've done a lot of work to try and make it more safe for riders, but there's still no chance for support cars to be on that mountain. It would have been 37 kilometres without any support for any riders. Of course, the big question is, if somebody had an accident, how on earth would you tend them? And they couldn't do that, so they decided Monte Crostis comes out. Now, they did put a little second category climb in called Toiles, which is on the shoulder of Monte Crostis. That is now been removed as well. That is exactly what I was hearing on the headphones just as I shut up there. They have taken that out, and they'll just carry along the straight road here until the bottom of the Monte Zoncolan. So there really is no other climbing at all now, Sean. It really is waiting, 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 waiting.
Yes, that's going to be all down to the Zoncolan, and it's turning out to be a very easy day. Getting rid of all these climbs already, the Crostis was taken out, the Twalis is out now, so there are two climbs left, so it's not going to be as a difficult day as we were expecting. But joking aside, Zoncolan is going to really test everybody, and it's going to make it interesting, because we're going to have a bigger bunch of riders. Normally on the previous climbs before we get to Zoncolan, there would be a sort of elimination where they would get rid of a lot of riders. Here we're going to have all the bunch coming together, so it's going to be more difficult positioning. There'll be a lot of teams, a lot of riders up there more, but the Zoncolan will sort them out very quickly with the percentage in the very early slopes.
Yep, it doesn't really, the climb itself, or the nasty bit of the climb, doesn't really start until 3 kilometres in. But then after that, it's 7 kilometres of absolute hell. Real, real hell. Gilberto Simoni, who's won twice on the Monte Zoncolan, says it is the worst climb he's ever been up. Rabottini, followed by Tankin, going on the inside there. And Brambilla. Took about 30 kilometres to get out in the breakaway, those three riders. They've been out ever since, and nobody's been at all worried about them, as you wouldn't be, because Bram Tankin is the best placed man on GC. He is 28 minutes and 25 seconds down. Rabottini is almost mind-numbingly interesting 2 hours and 1 minute and 13 seconds behind the pink jersey of Alberto Contador. Well, the gap has fallen quite significantly in the last 10 or 15 kilometres. Liquigas now, Sean, bringing Vincenzo Nibali towards the front. That's nice. Decorate your cows with balloons. If you put a few more on, they'll float. Lighter than air. I don't know much else you can say about that, really. Nibali and Scarponi will really be struggling at this. We saw Scarponi last year, and Nibali both having dreadful trouble in holding any sort of pace that Cadel Evans and Ivan Basso did. They went side by side by side for a long, long time, but then eventually Evans was dropped, almost cracked, not quite. Who do you see cracking first here, Sean, out of the, let's say, the big favourites all enter together, four or five of them, Kreuzinger, Nibali, Scarponi, a rider like Contador, obviously, yes, Ruhano, who do you see first being distanced?
I think we could see Nibali having difficulty here. He hasn't really cracked at all in this race, where Scarponi, he's tried to match Contador when he goes in the attack. and finds himself in difficulty, realizes that it's not possible and just have to knock off, and just picks it up very well, recovers out of, you know, the effort to try and stay with Contador for a short distance, I must say. Nibali has never really tried at all, and the steepness of this one, I think, you know, everybody will be really under pressure just to get up the climb and just to, you know, to stay in the group of big favourites. And I think Nibali, we could see him having a little bit more difficulty. Scarpone, he's a real fighter, and you know, he will just keep on fighting all the way. Klusinger as well, we see with the team, he's the big leader, and he's there all the time, but never you know, has made any movement. And will he try and do something today? I doubt it very much. So I think for me, to put my head on the block, Nibali might be the one of the big favourites, would lose a bit extra time than the likes of Scarponi, Klusinger. Anton, I think he's the one today that we might see a bit more present with the big favourites in the final.
Is it possible we might see some of the climbers we've not seen so far? We saw Seller attack at very early in the Vuelta a España on one of the stages into the Giro d'Italia into Oviedo. Liable to see a rider like that, or are they just simply not good enough this year?
Well, I think if you look at Seller's performance yesterday, he was, you know, quite a bit off. He finished 3:13 down, a bit disappointing. But again, the weather conditions might have affected him, that colder conditions in the end. And some riders, you know, when it is cold like that, and it was very icy rain, they did not get a lot of it for a long time. It was very much in the end, but still, I think he's a guy that would suffer from that. Possibly today, if they get the drier conditions, he might be able to do something. And the real, you know, lightweight climbers, there's the advantage today with the percentage here. They are the ones who we could see, you know, coming more to the fore.
Into the smaller roads that lead towards Monte Zoncolan now. Hundreds of thousands of people turning out to watch the finish in Zoncolan. The climb of Simoni, as you can see. Just about 6.5 minutes separate our three breakaway men, Rabotini, Bram Tankink, and Gianluca Brambilla, from the rest of the peloton. It's beginning to get more like a race now, as they open up the taps behind in the peloton to bring back these three men, set their team leaders up for some sort of showdown on the Zoncolan. Personally, I can't see too many people challenging Contador, and if Rohan is still in good shape from yesterday, same thing. You never know though, Sean. It's such an unpredictable sport at times that you never know. You might get a Contador on Zoncolan and he might just blow up. Who knows?
Yes, it is. That's the good thing about bike racing. It's so unpredictable. I think the Zoncolan is also such a difficult one. Hard to get, you know, to pull a name out there and say he could be the one today. And things can change so much. But again, I don't see Contador having problems. He's not that style of rider. And although he did have a problem a number of years ago in the Paris-Nice, but that was very early season. I think the form he's in at the moment, he is at his best or very close to it, and he's going to be there. It's the other ones who is going to, you know, come out of that group of favourites and maybe put up a better performance than we have seen him do in the past days in the mountains.
Certainly Liquigas are keen to get Vincenzo Nibali up towards the best possible position here, Sean, because they have come to the front to shut this gap down, or to try and shut this gap down.
Well, of course, yes. Nibali, Liquigas, the descending, that's where they're really good. And of course, Nibali is a real good descender. Maybe they're going to try something here just to push it on the descent. I don't see the reason for them riding at the moment all the way to the bottom of the climb, because Nibali, you know, he's not in that shape where they should take control of the race. I would reckon just to do the descent here, and maybe they have something up their sleeve that they might try and cause problems to Contador on the descent. And for the moment, looking at the past days, that is about the only place at this moment I can see him putting Contador in difficulty.
I wonder if secretly Nibali was thinking, well, perhaps on that, on the Monte Cross, this, even if they went, even if nobody was taking it at a dangerous speed, he could possibly put Contador under a little bit of pressure because he is such a fantastic descender. I wonder if he'll regret not being able to have that opportunity.
Well, I think that opportunity is, you know, out there. If you study the route each day, the riders, they will, you know some of the important stages, and they will have ridden over some of them. The Italian teams, of course, they will be, you know, very much aware of a lot of the roads they're going over, the descents of all the climbs to come in the final week. And you know, Contador, right, you know, he will have to be very careful there on the days, because if there's an opportunity at all, the terrain presents itself to do that, we could see him trying something, considering like the possibilities are, you know, really minimum for Nibali and the Liquid Gas to try something, and that could be one of the tactics. As we can see here, they're just pushing it on. Will they continue on all the way to the final climb of the day? We'll have to wait for a bit and see.
There is the awful prospect, of course, that in a couple of weeks' time, the Court for Arbitration of Sport may decide that Alberto Contador is to be banned and not to be allowed to race anymore, in which case, this, if he does win this Giro d'Italia, it would be completely meaningless. You never think like this, Sean, but is there any, well, I'm sure, but is there anywhere in the back of any of the other riders' minds that they might be thinking, look, we've got to fight, we're fighting in a different race?
Well, I doubt it very much. I think for the moment, you know, you just continue on the race, and you make your calculation on your feeling, first of all, and a place on the podium, the top step on the podium is always, you know, the big dream for the riders. But again, if you feel you're not able to do that, you know, you start calculating, and not 100% calculating at this moment, you know, about the second and third place, but you always think about it. And I think for the Italians, you know, the podium is very important, and they're still thinking of winning this race. I would say Nibali has still intentions that he could win this race, because the terrain to go, and you always expect, you're always hoping that, you know, this big forum of Contador will not last, and there will be opportunities as we go with such a difficult final week.
See the long cage derailleur there on the bike of Alberto Contador. God, they're starting to drill it here at the front. Our Liquid Gas. Still a fair way out, and with 6 minutes still to make up, it's a race within a race, really. These are our three breakaway men. Tankink is the rider at the back. Particularly lovely road surface, this, but there it is. Man in the middle is Rabottini, and the smaller of the riders at the front is Gianluca Brambilla of Colnago CSF. Be a nice touring country, wouldn't it? Lovely. Quite sure I fancy touring up the Zoncolan very often. Well, they just have to plug on as hard as they can, these three riders now, with Liquid Gas upping the pace behind. No real sign of Lamprey doing any work on the front for Scarponi at the moment. He is a real fighter, though, as we said. Scarponi battled like mad. That's Simon Spilak of Lamprey here. He's a good all-round rider and quite a good climber, too. You see Vaikkanen just to his left-hand side, the Finnish champion riding for Omega Pharmaloto. Under 35 kilometres to go, then, for our three breakaway men. We're going to take our final commercial break. This is stage 14 of the Giro d'Italia. We are getting into the final stages. It's Lenzta Monte Zoncolan. It says 190 kilometres there. Little bit of a situation been going on today with shortening the stage. Monte Crostis has not been included after all. If you're just joining us, that's the news. Monte Crostis is not in this race anymore. Oh, there's Pozzovivo. Now, what's he doing back there? That is the wrong place for you to be, sir. You're meant to be the climber of the team, as Liquigas are setting the pace on the front here. Monte Cross is not in the race anymore. It was left to a small climb called Twilis, which was on the shoulder of Monte Crostis, to take up the GPM points at that point. Now, we understand from the race organisers that that too has been taken out. They will continue on the road they're on through around the outside of Twilis, and the route will be even shorter. It was meant to be 210 kilometres, then it's 190, it's going to be even shorter now. So this, I think, is why one of the reasons that the teams, other teams, are coming to the front trying to organise things, because things are changing quite quickly. The race organisers are saying things as the race goes on, and I think people like Liquid Gas don't want to be caught out.
Well, I think with the terrain again here, we can see it is very technical, and the Liquid Gas on the front there, technical descent, and you know, difficult terrain. They are going up again a bit, and they're just trying something here, I suppose, to keep Nibali on the front. I think that is the only reason.
Yeah, this is I think where they have they're coning off, basically. They're sealing off the route up to Twilis, and they're going to send them around a different route. Now the organizers have made that decision,
and the spectators on the climb coming back down and in a rush here to see the riders as they get through.
Yep, they're going to go right here instead of going up the small climb of the smaller climb of Twilis. They're just going to carry on now, and these three riders will be upon that fairly shortly. So the action on the Zoncolan is going to be quicker than we expected. We're in the Karnak Alps today. Zoncolan's only been used three times before, 2003, 2007, and last year. Gilberto Simoni won the first two occasions we came up here, and he's still a huge hero, Gilberto Simoni, and very popular in Italy. He had his swan song at Giro d'Italia last year. Tried to get away over the Passo di Gavia with Johann Chopp, who's having quite a good race, actually, by the way, Johann Chopp, the Swiss rider. And it was Chopp, in fact, who took the stage. He rode away from Gilberto Simoni. He tried very hard to make it a big exit, did Simoni, but he wasn't the rider that he once was in the high mountains. Still extremely popular, though. And he won on the Zoncolan the first two times they went up, in 2003 and 70. He said it's the hardest climb he's ever done. There really is only one other Grand Tour climb that is comparable to this one in terms of steepness and hardness. That is the Anglero that is used occasionally in the Vuelta de España. Oops, they get around there, okay. But really, in the Tour de France, there are no climbs that match this one. I can't think of anything that ever matches this in terms of steepness, Sean, can you?
No, I don't think there's anything that comes near in the Tour of France, and the one in the Vuelta is the only one that comes near it. This is by far the most difficult one in all the big three-week tours. We can see the Liquid Gas there pushing on there, and a big line of riders behind. We did see there, you mentioned Pozzo Vivo, a long ways off in the peloton, seemed to be caught out a bit, but yesterday wasn't in a good position either in the finish. He was 20 minutes 43 down, so it doesn't seem to be these in the shape that would be expected to be in those style of stages, which really suit him. And it'll be interesting to see as the Liquid Gas, you know, push on all the time, is there splits back in the group? And I reckon there is there. It's, looking at the terrain, we're coming down, I think the peloton will split a bit, and they could be riders in the general classification getting caught out.
The riders to watch out for when we get to the Zoncolan, clearly the big favourites, and already Liquid Gas through those little tiny switchback sections, the lining out the peloton, and there's a pretty big split already, Sean, and there's a whole load of people down the back of the peloton who've slid off the back, and they will just go up whatever speed they can now.
Well, it depends again, you know, if there's some of the big favourites back
there,
it's going to cause a problem, and a panic will set in, and we could see, you know, just a bit further on that we have a chasing group behind the big group of favourites there. What is there, about 45 to 50 riders in that first group, so it's very possible there could be a number of them caught out and having to chase, and that's something you do not need before you get to a climb like the Zoncolan. If you have to make a chase in the valley, well, you're going to pay for that later.
Somebody writing in, Adilas, writing in saying there are, of course, steeper climbs in Europe. There are, but we were just talking about Grand Tour climbs. The Kitzbühler horn in the Tour of Austria, 7 kilometres at 11.7% average. Ooh. The Rettenbachferner in the Deutschlander Tour, 10% over 12 kilometres. Ouch. Well, it was forecast to rain in the finish of the Giro d'Italia de Zoncolan today. It was certainly drizzling earlier in the day. Thankfully, due to protests, that's interesting. Stage, we didn't hear that before, stage reduced by 20 kilometres due to protests. Oh, that protests by the team managers, possibly. Or is that the reduction of an extra 20 kilometres? Who knows? It's all a little bit confusing at the moment because they've taken out the second category Twalis climb as well as the Monte Crostis climb. Twalis was on the shoulder of Monte Crostis, and you saw them blocking off the road so that when the peloton arrives, they will swing right and don't do Twalis at all. So it's all a little bit confusing. Look, 10 kilometres left now. We've got 10.3 kilometres. That can't be right, surely. 10.3 kilometres. They've taken out an awful lot then, if that's the case, and we should almost be on the mountain as it is, if it's 10.3 kilometres. Well, next time we look at the breakaway group, they should be already on the Zoncolan, if that is the case. It is being told us is the distance left to go in this stage, which means our three breakaway riders, Brambilla and Rabotini and Tankink, should be on the Zoncolan now. Well, indeed, Sean, they've chopped out a whacking great lump by not going out the Twalis, and suddenly the race is transformed.
Yes, well, it's a lot of changes today, and of course, you know, the big one, the crust is taken out early. Yesterday evening it was announced, and now we're just getting the news there as we go on the route. The Twalis are taking it out very late, and this is going to, you know, it's going to be a situation, or it could be a situation more so, where the teams could have a bit of problem. But at the moment, with the way things are out in front, I don't think there's going to be any major problem, because the three riders out in front, the advantage is not any danger. And if teams are making a calculation for the stage victory, I don't think it should be a problem, because this three-man breakaway is, you know, coming down very quickly.
Thank you for those people who are using Twitter for the very best possible way of communicating information very quickly. Thank you. A number of people today, Michael Beattie, Simon McMichael, Tom Hibbard, all telling me that, or telling us that this protest by fans, apparently, Tifosi, on a Twalis that has made them take it out. They're actually complaining about Monte Crostis not being included. So they've decided to take that out straight away as well, which means that these three men have arrived at the foot of the Monte Zoncolan a bit sooner than they expected. Well, a good or a bad thing. Maybe a good thing in energy levels, it may be a bad thing in mental preparation, I don't know.
It would have been a real good thing if they had taken that 15-minute advantage.
Absolutely.
And if the teams were calculating, well, we can have 8 minutes, allow them 8 minutes before they get to the Zoncolan, 8 or 9 minutes, and then suddenly they're taking 20 kilometres out. It could have worked well in the favour of the breakaway, but unfortunately they never had the advantage, enough time to have any chance of staying out there.
But it has meant that at the front of the peloton, what little information has got back to the peloton, it's impossible. We don't have access to the Director Sportive's instructions and radios, but it may be that some riders have been tailed off here. Looks to me, Sean, as though most of the favourites are in here. Is this Gadre fighting up to the back of the peloton? Well, the two men who are trying to get back here, both AG2R men. It's Yuri Christoph was one of them, Kritsov. Whoop!
He actually turned left.
Nocentini and Kritsov, I think, are
yes,
the two riders.
Yes,
went the wrong way.
One of the stewards there were sending, for some reason he was pointing to the left as the rider approached him, and the AG2R rider took the wrong road.
Looked like it did. Oh, it's a nightmare. It's a total nightmare. And now, why the motorcycles got to men with bicycles on? That's because the cars cannot go up Monte Zoncolan. It is too narrow and too steep for cars to go up. So it is an absolute panic situation, Sean, because those cars have got to get their motorcycles ready, got to get the bikes with their nominated riders and mechanics on the motorcycles to get up into the right place. Because the race has been shortened, all sorts of panic setting in.
Yes, major panic there. We can see it within the riders, the mechanics also major problems, and it's the liquid gas have, you know, created that, went in the attack on the descent, and we could see the team cars were only allowed up just some moments ago, some of them, and I think a lot of panic with the director sportifs trying to get to the rear end of this group of big favourites for the mechanics to get on the motorbikes for the final 10 kilometres.
So just to reiterate then, final 10 kilometres, there's no mechanics allowed, well, no cars allowed up the Monte Zoncolan. Nice little memory to Franco Ballerini. No cars allowed up the Zoncolan. A mechanic, a nominated mechanic, has to get on the back of a motorcycle with a spare bike. That's all they've got. Sometimes they can have a spare bike and a couple of spare wheels if they've got enough hands. Spizzioletti is the man from Lampre in the shot there. There is Vincenzo Nibali, you can see. Behind him is Steven Kreuzvik. Alberto Contador sitting with Richie Port as a teammate on his wheel at the moment. A little bit of order maybe coming back, who knows. Spezialetti's looking over his shoulder to see where his team leader Michele Scarponi is. He catches sight of him maybe because he's got back on the pace again. He's done this job for quite a long time, Spezialetti, for one team or another. The next man you could see is Valerio Agnoli of Liquigas. He's the last man in line for Vincenzo Nibali. They don't have a Sylvester Schmid here, unfortunately. There is Jose Rujano in the green climber's jersey. Well, what an interesting situation we've had develop in the last 10 kilometres alone. Because the race organisers, the very last minute, deciding to leave out the climb of Tuales. Pablo Lastras just drifting a little bit off the back, didn't have the clearly have the legs to stay up with the main contenders. There is Lastras, and it looks like Garzelli just ahead of him. Sastra passing him. Sastra off the back, but he'll just grind his way up, as is his style. Kirienka, I can see right at the back of the group there with his hat, his helmet slightly jauntily awry. Sastra, you can see just in the back of your shot there for Geox. Visconti ahead of him on the road, the Italian champion. There's what, about 30 riders in this group now? And only two men remaining from the breakaway group. It's Gianluca Brambilla and Bram Tanking. This is a devil of a climb, Sean, really horrible.
Certainly is, and the way you come to the climb as well, difficult for a lot of the riders. I think some riders maybe, you know, in a position they would not like to be in, a bit further back in the main bunch.
Good bit of air time for Colnago CSF as the smaller of our two remaining breakaway riders, Gianluca Brambilla, heads off ahead of Bram Tanking on the climb of Zoncolan. It'll just get steeper and steeper. Brambilla has already held the mountains classification jersey for a while. And Yoli doing a good job. Denis Menchov standing on the pedals, just looking out across the fields to see where the next ramps in this climb come. Turning over a fairly big gear, and it's good to see Menchov up to the towards the front. We didn't see him at all until yesterday, the Grossglockner, but he's clearly in reasonable form even to be at this point.
Yes, he is showing more. It's the first time, I suppose, in the earlier part of the climb, still a bit over 7 kilometres to go, that we have seen Denis Menchov appearing up in the top four or five riders. Yesterday we did see him in the end, but it was much in the very end. And will he be the guy today who will, you know, try and put in an attack there? And of the big favourites, he might be the one that we could see putting on more of a show today, because we do need it. And the more the merrier we have from the big favourites, you know, going in the attack and trying something apart from Contador.
Look of determination on the face of Gianluca Brambilla. About 30 men in this group of chasers, including all the big favourites. Vincenzo Nibali is in here. We've already seen Joaquim Rodriguez is in here. Kirienka right at the back. Did so well yesterday. I think it's a little bit too steep for him today. Brambilla rode in last year's Tour of Britain, if I remember correctly. It's a fierce pace being forced on the front here, Sean.
Yes, they are really going at it, giving it a good run at the moment, and it's you know, really lining out the group as we come to the section now where it's going to start really kicking up. And I think we will see a lot of riders going out the rear end of this group. Still 35 riders maybe, but it will really blow apart, as we can see Brambilla here on a steep section really just struggling to keep it turning.
And Yoli putting on the pressure at the front for Liquigas. Niemiec on the left of your screen, ahead of his team leader, Michele Scarponi. In the middle of the shot, 1-1-1, is Vincenzo Nibali. On his left-hand shoulder, nice to see, Konstantin Svitsov is still there at the moment. The pink jersey of the race leader, Alberto Contador, moves smoothly through the group. Dario Cataldo still climbing well, he's on the wheel of Alberto Contador, but little by little you'll get riders who simply cannot do anything anymore. Joaquim Rodriguez. Oh, well, I did wonder if that was going to be the case. I wasn't going to say whether he's chasing or leading, but he's just decided to set a higher pace of his own at the moment. Suits him, a very steep sort of climbing. Marco Pinotti. Well, Joaquim Rodriguez has got a fair old way to make up on general classification. He is 5 minutes and 26 seconds down. But having said that, though, Sean, he could make 2, maybe 2.5, maybe even 3 minutes if he was going real hard on a climb like this.
Well, I think it's an interesting one that he goes in the attack just as we come under the 7 kilometres to go. It will be a good move by Joaquim Rodriguez, and who will be the ones to chase, because the general classification, of course, you know, he's a bit further down. But again, I think we will see a reaction. If Contador is, you know, not going to react, and I don't think he's going to be concerned about Joaquim Rodriguez for the moment, it will be the other ones, as we can see. You know, some of the other ones down the general classification cruising at the moment, you know, very much to the fore here. Is that Tiro Longo?
Yep.
Setting the pace, and it's looking interesting at the moment. That's what we need, you know, some more teams to get involved. With Liquigas really upping the pace there, is Nibali in good shape? He must be feeling okay, because otherwise the Liquigas team would not commit and really make it difficult into the bottom slopes of the climb.
Dreadfully steep section that Gianluca Brambilla is on at the moment. 22% at about 3.5 kilometres into the climb. Well, you can tell how steep this climb is, because even a rider like Contador, who can usually look so light and agile on the pedals, is just, the bike just hurtles around underneath him. On the far side, opposite Alberto Contador, and climbing with a similar sort of style when he gets out of the saddle, is Jean Gadre from AG2R. Steepest, one of the steepest parts of this, the whole of the climb here for Gianluca Brambilla. Now Igor Anton. Sean, exactly as you predicted, Igor Anton is the man who is capable of trying to launch another attack. So two Spaniards now, or a Basque and a Spaniard, have gone up the road ahead of the third Spaniard in this group, who's leading Alberto Contador.
Yes, it's looking good, and it's nice to see these, you know, favourites that we would be expecting to do something on a day like today going in the attack. Joaquim Rodriguez, now Anton, but Contador reacting pretty quickly, as we can see here, just riding off the front of the group of main favourites. And who is going to be able to follow? Cruisinger, we did see very much the four. They have to react now, because with the three Spaniards moving away, they need to react pretty quickly.
They're going to have to react amazingly quickly, because Alberto Contador has shut the gap down to Igor Anton almost immediately. It's behind two Lampre men, Scarponi, and I would guess Nimietz, who's the last man standing for Lampre, trying to drag Scarponi back up to the wheel of the leader of this Giro d'Italia. Bram Tankink, capable of grinding away, big, strong rider, is now inch by inch worked his way back up to Gianluca Brambilla's wheel. Well, that's a display of the sort of force that Alberto Contador can muster when he wants to, Sean, because here comes the battling Scarponi. But Contador thought, right, I want to shut this one down, a little bit too dangerous. Off he went, shut it down pretty quickly, considering how steep this is.
Yes, and I think it's a good indicator that, again, Contador is, you know, in no difficulty at all, because he could just play the waiting game, allow the other favourites to start doing the chasing, and Scarponi, for example, is taking it up, and Contador could have waited for that move, but just moves on into the wheel of Anton and follows on here at the moment. Joaquim Rodriguez, I haven't seen. I presume he's in between here, ahead of the group of Anton and Contador.
I have to presume that. We've not seen him come back at all. He must still be ahead of Igor Anton. Scarponi out of the saddle, not too far down at the moment on Alberto Contador. You just have to wonder whether Contador is waiting, biding his time. There is Vincenzo Nibali, and there is Jose Rujano, looking as though he's suffering a little bit, Jose Rujano. The bike just swaying gently underneath him, clearly not solid in the saddle. There is Joaquim Rodriguez. That's good riding by Igor Anton, and Alberto Contador being not paced, but he's just taking his pace from the back of Igor Anton's wheel. I don't think they're going at absolutely full throttle yet, because Scarponi's not too far behind here. This is best young rider, Roman Kreuzinger. Kreuzinger, I think, is going to suffer on the steeper parts of this slope if somebody starts to accelerate soon. And look at the gap that's been put in by these three men here. Igor Anton, Alberto Contador and Joaquim Rodriguez, with Scarponi just behind, and a rider like Roman Kreuziger. Tankink has gone ahead, I would suggest, of Brambilla. We've not seen Brambilla. Has he gone up the road a little bit more? I would imagine that Tankink has passed him. Scarponi makes the wheel. And so there are four. Anton's going to look over his shoulder. Who's going to make the next big dig here? Look at the tiny gear that Igor Anton is turning, Sean.
Yes, he's turning well, and it's a good way to be for the moment. Still 6 kilometres to go, and I think a lot of them are playing the waiting game. Contador especially, he's going to wait here. He has really no interest in going at this point. And you know, when you look at what's come on this climb, the very steep sections, there are a lot of them up ahead. 6 kilometres, it's a long ways on a difficult mount like this, as we see Nibali battling big time here, just to limit his losses. Menchoff are just a bit further back. Cruisinger, we did see a bit further back there, and he seemed to be losing time. One of the favourites, which was a bit further off, seemed to have lost contact with that group of Menchoff.
Well, it looks like a Belgian fan who's going to adopt a Dutchman at the moment is Bram Tankink.
Surprising to see a Belgian cheering on a Dutchman.
Well, in the absence of a Belgian at the front, he'll surely be cheering on Cattell, though. Even though he's not a Belgian, he's wearing a Belgian jersey.
Well, if you have a Belgian jersey, the Belgian team, you're, you know, regarded as half Belgian. He's still not a Dutch.
Anton continues to set the pace at the front, turning up tiny, tiny gear. A lot of these riders using, some of the guys using compact, some of them using a very tiny inner chainring, a lot of them using great big dinner plates for sprockets at the back. Alberto Contador has already changed his bike once. He did the same yesterday in the Grossglockner. He's done the same today. I wouldn't be surprised if he does the same tomorrow. Vincenzo Nibali on the drops. The late Marco Pantani used to habitually climb on the drops, but it's not very common.
And Joachim Rodriguez lost a little bit of us from a three leaders here at the moment, so he's getting into a bit of difficulty. Nibali just battling on here, and on a climb like this, you know, you just have to be careful. If you go into the red, well, then you pay big time because of the grading of the climb, so you have to, you know, calculate it very well.
Rodriguez will have to time himself very well. This is, oh, look at this. Then we go back to the front and front of this little group, and Igor Anton continuing to put the pressure on the men behind. Scarponi moves around Alberto Contador. I think he'd be quite happy to let Scarponi do the pacemaking here. None of these men who are around Alberto Contador with this sort of gap is going to threaten for the overall classification at the moment. They have to put in such an enormous attack and break Alberto Contador. And as long as he can just keep turning the pedals, Contador, and keep them within reach, keep them within distance, then he's not going to be worried.
No, not going to be worried. And the interesting one is, is Contador suffering a little bit? Why did he leave Anton go on? Is he just making Scarponi do the work here, and the Spanish just working the Italian over a bit? I think, you know, Contador is not in a difficulty. But again, you're never sure. You can be so good for many days and suddenly have a little bit of an off day. And if you have that here today, well, then the crack will be seen. As Contador just sits on Scarponi and leaves him do the tempo setting after Anton.
Hope we get that overhead shot once again, because you can just see the difference in pedaling in terms of speed between Scarponi and Contador. Contador turns the pedals much, much lighter away as Igor Anton has come past Rabottini and is now coming up to a very difficultly battling Brambilla. He's all over the road, really suffering now and being in the break all day. Anton will go up the inside of him. Brambilla will have to watch it. He doesn't know he's there, poor lad. Oh, it shows how steep it is, Sean. There's a million and one amateurs who know that feeling of weaving side to side.
Yes, and when you get into that rhythm where it's really going slow and difficulty to keep is turning, moving a bit from left to right, as you can see here, Scarponi, you know, climbing quite well, Contador really just spinning there, and if you can climb that way, it's a great way to do it, and not as energy sapping, where if you're on a gear struggling, it does sap your energy very quickly.
You're looking down from the helicopter with 5 kilometres to go, just about, or at least we should be very accurate on the Zoncolan. 5.1 kilometres to go. Every 100 metres is like hell for these men. Scarponi looking good at the moment. He's turning the pedals over smoothly, but look at the way Contador is turning them over much quicker. The gearing much lower for him. Tankink, this man is at the front of the race. He's been in the breakaway today. He's still leading the race on the road. A tremendous performance because he isn't a climber. Scarponi out of the saddle. Contador still sitting there, turning. It doesn't look to me as though he's giving it 100%. Wait, not giving it 100% at all. Your assessment of the body language of Contador here, Sean?
I think he's a little bit hunched over the handlebars here, and I would reckon that he's not as comfortable maybe in the pass, but again, it's difficult to see, but as we go on up this climb, time will tell. He is a little bit, I think, more difficult than we've seen him in the past. Normally he gets in and out of the saddle a lot as well, and he's not doing that, so I would reckon that not as comfortable as in the past, certainly not as he was yesterday.
They're inching it up, I think, a little bit on Igor Anton, who was riding ahead of them. He's put a turn of speed on and got away. But I think that under the pace of Scarponi, they're beginning to just eat in. If you're just joining us, we're in the last 5 kilometres of the Monte Zoncolan. No cars allowed up here. That's why the mechanics are on the back of motorcycles. That was Alberto Contador's motorcycle mechanic just going past Vincenzo Nibali to be behind their team leader and the race leader there, Alberto Contador. Nibali is all by himself. You'll see him coming around the corner there. Is it an advantage or a disadvantage mentally, Sean, to be isolated, to be by yourself, just 20, 30 metres away from somebody?
I think the advantage is somebody's out in front. It's an advantage, a little advantage on the climbs, but it's a very little one. And depending on how you're feeling as well, if you're closing down on the guys in front of you, in the Nibali case, for example, if he can see just up in front there, that group, I think it's Contador and Scarponi he should be seeing, and you're just closing down gradually, well, then that is good for morale, and it gives you that a bit more morale to push on a bit more.
Is Nibali making any ground at all on Alberto Contador and Michele Scarponi? I'm not at all sure he is. In fact, I think that it's just sliding a little bit away from him. Scarponi with Contador quite happy to sit. I say happy to sit on his shoulder. They both pass Bram Tankink. Igor Anton is now the leader on the road. This is the man who is leading today's stage. If he wins on Monte Zoncolan, that will be a massive feather in his cap. Out of the saddle, and he's got a fairly good gap at the moment on these three men as it is now. How long will Bram Tankink be able to stay with these two? Not a whole lot of time, I wouldn't think. Oh! As it has perhaps evened out a little bit. Vincenzo Nibali is coming back towards the wheel of Contador and Scarponi here.
This will be interesting if Nibali can, you know, join up with Scarponi, Contador. We could see him trying to attack, because again, you know, he's closed down that gap very gradually, and we will see very, very quickly how good Contador is. If Nibali is capable of putting in an attack, will he react immediately? Because I think Contador is just playing the Spanish card here at the moment. He's just allowing Igor Anton to pull away. No danger in the general classification. He's just going to sit and allow Scarponi to do all the pace setting here.
Oh, that's cruel. There's a gentleman there with a fishing rod with a piece of beef on it, dangling it in front of Alberto Contador. Oh, problems with one of the motorcycles.
They're leaving over. Heating.
Yeah, I think that'll be an overheating problem.
And cruising get at 140 at the moment, so he is in major difficulty, as we see quite a bit further down. He was losing contact on that group of Menchov and seemed to be losing all the time.
I'll tell you what, if you wanted any indication of how difficult this mountain is, if you can blow a gasket or a water pipe on one of these motorcycles and get it overheating, you know how steep it is. Must do the clutches. Horrors. That's Tankink in all types of hell here. Denis Menchov having to set his own pace, and Nibali has made the junction. He's got across as Alberto Contador looks. Now, has Nibali got enough in the tank to look across and take on Alberto Contador? That is what he's going to do. He's decided that he's got to force the pace along a little bit. Contador responds. He has to respond, Sean, because Nibali is the man closest to him in the overall classification, albeit 3 minutes back now.
Yes, well, that is the big test now for Contador. Can he match Nibali? And we could see there immediately he just goes takes the wheel of Nibali. And, you know, he's the man that he's concerned about. And concerned about both the two Italian Scarponi also. He's not going to allow him to take any time if he can do it. And it looks like that he's just, you know, just going to sit with Nibali for the moment. And I'll not be surprised if we see Contador, you know, putting in an attack a bit later. Still 4 kilometres to go. It's just coming down so slowly. The kilometres they take for ever here.
Vincenzo Nibali is here more than being sat on here. Nibali is putting the real effort in this slightly flatter section of the Zoncolan to try and shed or put pressure on Alberto Contador. Remember, he's trying to put pressure on Scarponi as well. Scarponi is much closer to Nibali than Nibali is to Contador, so if he can put the pressure on Scarponi more than anybody else, I think he'll be happy. I think he realises, Sean, Nibali is going to have real trouble getting rid of Alberto Contador. But he could well destroy, or at least try and destroy, Michele Scarponi here.
Yes, well, if he feels that Scarponi is in difficulty, he will, you know, just really give it everything. And at the same time, he'll just test Contador, see can you put Contador under difficulty. It's not with just one attack you're going to, you know, test Contador, because he will, you know, really dig in. If he's suffering a lot, he will still, you know, react to the sudden acceleration we see by Nibali there. So Nibali just have to keep making a very fast pace and not go off the road.
There's a lot of looking over at Alberto Contador from Vincenzo Nibali. Nibali, who's worn the pink jersey in the Giro d'Italia, not this one, but last year, has won the Vuelta a España. He's up against a man who's won all three Grand Tours. And he's certainly putting distance into Michele Scarponi, which must, I would think, be his major objective today. And Scarponi looks as though he's blown here, Sean, to me, almost blown. Looks as though he's just digging away, but it's so difficult to tell on a climb like this.
Yes, it's really difficult, and Scarponi is a rider, when you look down on him, he looks to be really suffering, because his pedaling cadence is very slow, because he uses much a heavier gear, but the gap is not great for the moment. And we've seen Scarponi before get into a little bit of difficulty, lose 20-30 metres and just, you know, crawl his way back again. But on this one, if you are a little bit on the limit and at the end of your energy levels, you know, the gap opens up very quickly, and 50 metres here, it's a lot in time.
This is Denis Menchov we're looking at, and I have a feeling Menchov is riding a little bit better than those riders in front of him now. Certainly Scarponi, I would not be at all surprised to see Menchov eating up on that lead, the gap between himself and Scarponi. Meanwhile, Igor Anton of the Basque Giuscatel Ascari squad is ahead of everybody else. He's putting in every effort he can to win this stage today. Igor Anton, who started the day at 4 minutes and 2 seconds down. Remember, that's one of the other reasons I think Nibali has had to respond, because Anton's gone up the road and Nibali was only a minute ahead of him, in the general classification. And now they've had to make the effort. He's had to make the effort to not just attack Scarponi, but to eat up on that advantage that Igor Anton has got on the road.
Yes, and I think Nibali, we see him doing his familiar tactic, or his familiar way of riding up a climb, just gets into his rhythm. When there is sudden attacks, he doesn't react immediately, just keeps on walking at his pace, and that's what he's been doing on this climb, and it seems to be working out well, because when he's setting the pace here with Contador, it tells me that he's feeling okay. Has he got more left in the tank? Will he try and, you know, up the pace again? Will he put in one or two attacks before we get to the finish of this one? And he's doing a great job, because he's, you know, riding a Scarponi, putting a bit further off in the general classification, and it's all about, you know, the podium for the moment.
Nibali and Alberto Contador are actually closing the gap slightly. Come on, come through, do some work. No, not quite at the moment. The two of them clearly thinking about who is going to take the next effort. Contador comes through to sit at the front for a little bit. Nibali asked him to do so. Scarponi is the next man on the road behind them. Scarponi still battling away. The gradient drops very slightly, Sean, at this point, and it looks to me as though Scarponi is possibly making an advantage of that, although Igor Anton still has, 50 bike lengths. Scarponi beginning to come back on this slightly less heavy gradient.
Yes, and it's something we've seen Scarponi do before. He just claws his way back, coming back very slowly, and I think he seemed to be making up ground on Nibali Contador. And we can see Anton as well. I think that the two chasers, Nibali Contador, are making into the advantage of Anton at the moment. So it's a big battle here, and will they all the four join up before we get to this finish? And is there anybody capable of making an attack? Because if you can throw in a little bit of an attack here, it will put people under difficulty. As Nibali just tried to up the pace again, Contador taking it up in the front. I would not take too much from that, because again, sometimes that's what they do, just to bluff a little bit and say they're not really suffering. So Nibali, again, he just ups the pace, and he is going to keep on testing Contador as many times as he can before we get to the finish.
This is the only flat section in the whole of the climb, flattish section in the whole of the climb at 3 kilometres, and it only encompasses two bends, and then it rises horribly once again to 18%. Nibali and Contador riding together. There seems to be a cessation of real hostilities between these two at the moment as they try to get away from Scarponi. They have to test each other, have to keep looking at each other. It's an odd dynamic. They have to both look at each other, mark each other, and work together if they possibly can to urge each other on. They both have a different agenda. The biggest agenda, of course, is to try and win this Giro d'Italia. They both want to beat each other, but for a rider like Nibali, he's got to get rid of the man behind him if he possibly can, Michele Scarponi, and they put a bit more time into Scarponi there, and he's got to try and make up time on Igor Anton ahead of him so that Anton doesn't leapfrog him in the standings. How far down is Menchov? There he is at about the same distance as he was the last time we saw him. He looks like he's riding fairly well, but he doesn't like this really steep stuff. Never has. No sign anymore of Joaquim Rodriguez, Sean. He launched his attack at 7 kilometres out, and it didn't last more than about a K.
No, and it did not look good when we see him losing contact from Contador and Anton. He seemed to be in difficulty, and as the other riders started to come by, never really looked like he was going to take the wheel, and I think he's just losing more and more time as we go further on here.
Fans alongside of these two have to be a little bit careful. They're being very well behaved, actually. Start pushing riders and there can be real problems. They're not allowed to take that sort of assistance from fans at the side of the road. And if they do, you often see them occasionally get a sort of sneaky push and they'll turn around as if to bat them off and say, no, get away, because the commissaires can jump down their necks fairly quickly there. We're coming up to the section where it might get a little bit dangerous here, Sean, because they move so slowly up the Zoncolan here. Any fans who step out ahead of it could cause problems for any of these riders. And getting going on this gradient is really difficult.
Yes, it's really difficult. And we did see Nibali there just some moments ago. He almost went off the side of the road on the left-hand side.
And there is the first push we've seen, as if by magic, for Michele Scarponi. That's unsurprising, because we're in an Italian race, the Italian national race, and Scarponi, one of the big national favourites for this. Bit more difficult to give Nibali a push because he's right next to Alberto Contador. This is Jose Rojano, well, we expected a little more of Jose Rojano, but big question was at the beginning of the day, which we posed, will he have anything left after yesterday, having gone with Alberto Contador? Jean Gadre and Nieve. Anton is riding really well here. He's pulled out that gap ahead of the two riders behind. It's looking to me as though it's going to be Igor Anton's stage, Sean, at the moment.
Yes, looking very much in that way. And unless we see some of the attacks that are so familiar from Contador, but I doubt it very much because, you know, the Spanish team, Contador is just going to stay here in the wheel of Nibali, allow him just to ride and carry this one all the way to the finish.
Nibali just allowing, or shall I say Contador just allowing Nibali to be just ahead of him. Psychologically a good place to be. He can always stay on the shoulder, and Nibali is always going to be wondering what's going to happen. Is he going to launch an attack? What's going to go on? Oh, look at the crowd. That's better. First little push we see for Nibali. It's not going to be the last one either. I would be absolutely certain of that. Nibali trying to up the pace a little bit. Contador is just behind him. I think he's a bit, has to get into this narrow alleyway by himself. Turn on the pressure. Nowhere for Alberto Contador to attack him at this point. And up out of the saddle comes Contador. This is the style we know so well. And Nibali, we hardly ever see him get out of the saddle. He's just sitting there. He's just plugging away at his own pace. Meanwhile, Igor Anton, who led the Vuelta a España last year until a horrendously nasty crash at high speed amongst a bunch of favourites in the middle of the road, was removed from the Vuelta a España by that accident. That's a big gap he's got now, Sean. 30-odd seconds, I think. 30 seconds between Igor Anton and Nibali. And Nibali is now not concerned so much about putting time into Alberto Contador. He'll know he's there on the shoulder, and Contador's just going to ride him, ride on his wheel all the way up. He's more concerned about shutting down Igor Anton.
Yes, trying to shut down Anton, but I think he will be aware that the advantage 30 seconds is not going to be possible here, the way Anton is, you know, climbed in the last number of kilometres. He will be thinking about the general classification, and he know he's going to make progress in that situation. Nibali from Scarponi, he's going to move up and take quite a bit of time from Scarponi, and that's what he's working at. I think that's what he's calculating at the moment.
Inside the last kilometre and a half for Igor Anton, Geraint Jones asking why aren't we seeing any of the other guys down the hill. It's so small, this road, there's just not enough room and not enough camera bikes to pick up everybody. They'll be scattered absolutely everywhere. Occasionally, a little bit later on, when this battle is over, you will see a few of the riders from further down. They'll switch the cameras to back further, but they're concentrating on this at the top. It's the same for camera cars and mechanical cars following. A race radio just saying that Scarponi has a mechanical problem. Oh, it gets worse for Scarponi. He's been distanced by Nibali at the moment, and now he's dropped the chain. Apparently Scarponi drops the chain. He started the day 7 seconds only behind Vincenzo Nibali. Nibali in second place this morning. Under the flamme rouge goes Igor Anton. Just one more kilometre of suffering for the Basque rider to take the most prestigious win of his life by a long way. Oh, Nibali's done a magnificent job today, Sean. And look at Contador just sitting. He was sitting on the shoulder. Said it about a kilometre or so ago, sitting on the shoulder, putting that little bit of psychological pressure on Nibali. When is he going to go? When is he going to go? And now he's just gone. Oh, that must be soul-destroying.
Yes, and Nibali, he was probably, you know, thinking, is Contador in a little bit of difficulty, and just kept on working at it. And, of course, you know, he's in a situation where he's got to do that, thinking of the general classification and moving up. His advantage from Scarponi, but amazing the way Contador just, you know, ups the pace there, and Nibali just not even trying to react.
Igor Anton, it's well inside the last kilometre now. Contador has come out of that little battle he's going on with Vincenzo Nibali. How much time is Contador going to make up on him? He's surely not going to make up that 30 seconds. so difficult to tell at this moment because they've got to go through these very narrow tunnels. We lose all picture at all. Have to wait till they come out the other side. Here is Contador. So Igor Anton looks safe to me for the win here, Sean.
Yes, I think he's going to hold on, and we can see there the advantage is still probably, you know, 20 seconds, so he's going to win the best stage, the victory of Anton's career.
110 for Menchoff, 130 for Gadre, back from Igor Anton. This is a terrific ride. Well, it's taken him a while to recover. It was a nasty accident from the Vuelta a España last year. And started to come good in the Ardennes Classics. We saw him beginning to become the rider he was, being able to kick on the hills. And it's a very, very prestigious win for him today, especially to take it ahead of this man, Alberto Contador, who has been by far the class climber so far.
Yes, I think he will be happy with the way Contador has ridden also. You know, he just stayed there with Nibali, first of all with Scarponi, then stayed in the wheel of Nibali for a long time. And Contador, I reckon that he could have reacted when Anton went on, but again, he, you know, just allowed the other Spanish rider to have some glory in this one. And as we can see, Nibali seems to be maybe coming back to Contador in the final couple of hundred metres.
And he is indeed. Well done. Well done, Vincenzo Nibali. Coming back at Contador. I think he's going to go past him as well. He's going to have another go at him. Contador gets onto the pedals. Maybe he is just letting Igor Anton have his day. But Nibali is coming up to Contador's wheel. Anton takes a first place in this stage on the Monte Zoncolan. The winner in the most prestigious stage of this year's Giro d'Italia. Even without the Monte Crostis, what a battle. Igor Anton, the winner. He got eighth on Mount Etna. Remember, he was fifth in Flèche Wallonne this year. He began to come good. And Contador, trying to exercise his authority, kicks again ahead of Vincenzo Nibali. Ooh, the crowd don't like him. Oh dear, not a warm welcome for Alberto Contador. He looks over his shoulder as if to say, what's going on? Contador takes second. And Vincenzo Nibali, no such problems for him as he arrives. 39 seconds down on Igor Anton. Michele Scarponi being cheered on. Dropped a chain about 800 metres or so ago. But that's a fine battling performance from Scarponi. He is a fighter, if nothing else. But he's lost time again today to both Alberto Contador and Vincenzo Nibali. Finishes at 1:11. And here is Menchoff. As we thought, he was sort of still plugging away there. Menchoff coming in at 1:20. It's a case of Jean Gadre. And Herbert Dupont as well. Gadre over the line. 1:38 down for Gadre. Jose Rujano, he holds the... There's Nieve and Herbert Dupont coming in. Jose Rujano, not the threat that we perhaps thought he would be today. Konstantin Svitsov coming up towards the line ahead of Jose Rujano. That's a good day of rallying by Konstantin Svitsov. Had a bad day yesterday, one bad day. Seems to be going better again today.
Yes, a real good performance by Svitsov. And anybody finishing there, you know, at that time, 2 minutes, I think it's a real nice performance as we see Joaquim Rodriguez coming in.
Joaquim Rodriguez coming in, the rain beginning to fall, and oh, woe upon woe for some of the stragglers down the hill. Faced with Monte Zoncolan, and now the rain is coming down on them. Scarponi, head in hands. That's a great finish by Steven Kreuzweg. And he must be ahead, I would think, of Roman Kreuzinger on the road. Niemiec. Kreuzinger, one of the really big losers. We've not seen him arrive yet. And what was the gap today between Kreuzweg and Kreuzinger? 2 minutes and 56 seconds. Oh, evil. Absolutely evil. Here comes Romain Kreuzinger. Well, he's not lost 2 minutes and 56 seconds, but he has lost some time in the battle for best young rider, with Paolo Tirolongo just ahead of him. He's lost about 25 seconds or so, possibly 30 seconds to Kreuzvik. Ozoyan. Oh, it's hell this climb, Sean. Absolutely hell.
Yes, everybody coming over and just totally empty, and not surprising, you know, this is the gradient of this one. And luckily the rain, they're just getting in the final. If they had got that in the earlier part, it would have just made it an impossible task to get to this finish.
Le Mavel comes home. Cataldo. Well, a number of riders losing a whole fistful of time today, Sean, but the battle was really between Vincenzo Nibali, Igor Anton, and this is Vasily Kirienka, Igor Anton, Vincenzo Nibali, and Michele Scarponi today, really.
Yes, and Anton, you know, a great performance going out there a number of kilometres from the finish, and very impressive today. Nibali shown a bit more than he has in the past days, you know, able to make the set the pace on the front, but Contador, I think he was a little bit in more difficulty than we have seen him in all of this Giro, because when he went in the attack just inside the kilometre to go, Nibali came back at him and just gave that extra little bit of a kick in the end and rode away from Nibali again. But I think Contador suffering maybe because of the efforts yesterday as well, you know, going away and a number of kilometers of finish, as we see Rugano also in the same situation.
My estimation for the overall GC is that Contador is first, Nibali will be second, it'll be Egon Anton is third, and Scarponi will be fourth. Just looking at the timings, it was 39 seconds back to Nibali, 111 to Scarponi, 128 to Menchov, 138 to Gadre, which would mean that Gadre moves up into fifth overall. First will be Alberto Contador, second Vincenzo Nibali, third Igor Anton, fourth Scarponi, fifth Jean Gadre. That is the way I'm doing my maths anyway. I think that's the way it's going to be when we get confirmation in just a second. Scarponi losing out on a possible podium spot at the moment to the Basque rider. A terrific performance by Anton, but we've got another massive day in the mountains tomorrow, Sean.
Yes, I think another big day, and another day where we could see major upsets in the general classification.
Anton, Contador, Nibali, Scarponi, Menchov and Gadre, the first six to arrive at the line. 40 seconds back to Nibali, I had 39. 121 they have for Menchov, I had 128, but it's up to, they've got the official timings. Nieve at 152, Dupont, great riding again by Dupont. We thought he'd possibly suffer today, but he seems to be right up there. Konstantin Svitsov, 205. Jose Rujan, really suffering today. And Joaquim Rodriguez, definitely still not riding into top form. Getting better, but it's nowhere near good enough. Oh, there will be riders crawling up here for the next hour, pretty much. Look at the crowds that have lined the Zoncolan. That gives you an idea of how steep it is. Don't fancy that on a Sunday run. Here then is the provisional standings. Contador, Nibali at 320. Igor Anton at 321. Scarponi at 406. Gadre at 523. Svitsov at 5. 37. Menchoff climbs up to 7th spot from 11th. Herbert Dupont now 8th from 10th. Kreuziger slipping to 9th from 5th spot. David Arroyo slips to 10th from 4th spot. Joaquim Rodriguez, well, it's just not going to be his day, but the day on the Zoncolan belongs to the Basque rider Igor Anton, the most prestigious win of his career.